One thing have I desired of the Lord. Oh, one thing have I desired of the Lord, and that will I seek after. Yes, that will I seek after. Oh, one thing have I desired of the Lord. Yes, one thing have I desired of the Lord, and that will I seek after. And that will I seek after. Dwell in the house of the Lord all the days of my life, all the days of my life, that I will dwell in the house of the Lord. All the days of my life, all the days of my life, that I will dwell in the house of the Lord. All the days of my life, all the days of my life, that I will dwell in the house of the Lord. All the days of my life, all the days of my life, that I will dwell in the house of the Lord. All the days of my life, all the days of my life, I will dwell in the house of the Lord. All the days of my life, and the days of my life. Gaze upon the beauty of the Lord, seek Him in His temple. Gaze upon the beauty of the Lord, and seeking Him in His temple. Gazing on the beauty of the Lord and seeking Him in His temple. Gazing on the beauty of the Lord and seeking Him in His temple. Gazing on the beauty of the Lord and seeking Him in His temple. Gazing on the beauty of the Lord and seeking Him in His temple. One thing have I desired of the Lord, and that will I seek after. One thing have I desired of the Lord, and that will I seek after. One thing have I desired of the Lord, and that will I seek after. One thing have I desired of the Lord, and that will I seek after. That I might dwell in the house of the Lord all the days of my life, all the days of my life, I will dwell in the house of the Lord. All the days of my life, all the days of my life, that I will dwell in the house of the Lord. All the days of my life, all the days of my life, that I will dwell in the house of the Lord. All the days of my life, all the days of my life, that I will dwell in the house of the Lord. All the days of my life, all the days of my life, that I will dwell in the house of the Lord. All the days of my life, all the days of my life, that I will dwell in the house of the Lord. All the days of my life, all the days of my life, that I will dwell in the house of the Lord. All the days of my life, all the days of my life, gaze upon the beauty of the Lord, seeking Him in His temple. Gazing on the beauty of the Lord, seeking Him in His temple. Oh, gazing on the beauty of the Lord, seeking Him in His temple. Gazing on the beauty of the Lord, seeking Him in His temple. Gazing on the beauty of the Lord, seeking Him in His temple. Gazing on the beauty of the Lord, seeking Him. For you. the beauty of the Lord, seeking Him in His temple. We're gazing on the beauty of the Lord, seeking Him in His temple. Gazing on the beauty of the Lord, seeking Him in His temple. Dwelling with You forever, dwelling in the house of my God. One thing have I desired of the Lord, and that will I seek after. One thing have I desired of the Lord, and that will I seek after. One thing have I desired of the Lord, and that will I seek after. Yes, one thing have I desired of the Lord, and that will I seek after. Dwell in the house of the Lord all the days of my life, all the days of my life, that I would dwell in the house of the Lord all the days of my life, all the days of my life, that I would dwell in the house of the Lord all the days of my life, all the days of my life, that I would dwell in the house of the Lord all the days of my life, all the days of my life, that I would dwell in the house of the Lord all the days of my life, all the days of my life, and I will dwell in the house of the Lord. All the days of my life, all the days of my life, and I will dwell in the house of the Lord. All the days of my life, all the days of my life, oh, I will dwell in the house of the Lord. All the days of my life, all the days of my life, gazing upon the beauty of the Lord, seeking Him in His temple. Gazing on the beauty of the Lord, seeking Him in His temple. Gazing on the beauty of the Lord, seeking Him in His temple. Gazing on the beauty of the Lord, seeking Him in His temple. Gazing on the beauty of the Lord, seeking Him in His temple. Gazing on the beauty of the Lord, seeking Him in His temple. Gazing on the beauty of the Lord, seeking Him in His temple. Gazing on the beauty of the Lord, seeking Him in His temple. Gazing on the beauty of the Lord, seeking Him in His temple. Gazing on the beauty of the Lord, seeking Him in His temple. Gazing on the beauty of the Lord, seeking Him in His temple. Gazing on the beauty of the Lord, seeking Him in His temple. Gazing on the beauty of the Lord, seeking Him in His temple. Gazing on the beauty of the Lord, seeking Him in His temple. Gazing on the beauty of the Lord, seeking Him in His temple. One thing have I desired of the Lord, and that will I seek after. One thing have I desired of the Lord, and that will I seek after. One thing have I desired of the Lord, and that will I seek after. One thing have I desired of the Lord, and that will I seek after. That I would dwell in the house of the Lord all the days of my life, all the days of my life. That I would dwell in the house of the Lord all the days of my life, all the days of my life. That I would dwell in the house of the Lord all the days of my life, all the days of my life. That I would dwell in the house of the Lord all the days of my life, all the days of my life. That I would dwell in the house of the Lord all the days of my life, all the days of my life. That I would dwell in the house of the Lord all the days of my life, all the days of my life. That I would dwell in the house of the Lord all the days of my life, all the days of my life. That I would dwell in the house of the Lord all the days of my life, all the days of my life. Gazing on the beauty of the Lord, seeking Him in His temple. Gazing on the beauty of the Lord, seeking Him in His temple. Gazing on the beauty of the Lord, seeking Him in His temple. Gazing on the beauty of the Lord, seeking Him in His temple. Gazing on the beauty of the Lord, seeking Him in His temple. Gazing on the beauty of the Lord, seeking Him in His temple. Gazing on the beauty of the Lord, seeking Him in His temple. Take us to higher ground, a deeper place with You, Lord. Take us to higher ground, a deeper place with You. Take us to higher ground, a deeper place with You, Lord. Take us to higher ground, a deeper place with You. More of You, more of You. More of You, Lord, more. More of You, more of You. More of You, Lord, more of You. Oh, take us to higher ground, a deeper place with You. Take us to higher ground, a deeper place with You, Lord. Take us to higher ground, a deeper place with You. Oh, more of You. More of You, Lord, more. More of You, more of You. More of You, Lord, more. More of You, more of You. More of You, Lord, more. More of You, more of You. More of You, Lord, more. Take us to higher ground, a deeper place with You. But take us to higher ground, a deeper place with You. Oh, take us to higher ground, a deeper place with You. take us to higher ground, a deeper place with you. Oh, more of you, more of you, more of you, Lord, more of you, more of you, more of you, more of you, Lord, more of you, more of you, more of you, more of you, Lord, more of you. Oh, take us to higher ground, a deeper place for you. Oh, take us to higher ground, a deeper place with you. Oh, take us to higher ground, a deeper place with you. Take us to higher ground, a deeper place. Oh, more of you, more of you, Lord, more of you, oh, more. More of you, more of you, more of you, Lord, more. More of you, more of you, more of you, Lord, more. More of you, more of you, more of you, Lord, more. More of you, more of you, more of you, Lord, more of you. And take us to higher ground, a deeper place with you. Lord, take us to higher ground, a deeper place with you. Oh, take us to higher ground, a deeper place with you. Lord, take us to higher ground, a deeper place with you. Oh, more of you, more of you, more of you, Lord, more of you, more of you, more of you, Lord, more of you, Lord, more of you, more of you, more of you, more of you, Lord, more of you, more of you, more of you, more of you, Lord, more of you. Rain, rain, heaven's rain, falling on me. 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 Rain, rain, let it rain, falling on me. Rain, rain, heaven's rain, falling on me.
thank you for Jesus. Abba mamana kiste. Mamangale stibina. Ikaran.
Jesus, all of Jesus. up, oh Lord. Come and fill me up, oh Lord. Come fill me up till I overflow. Come fill me up, oh Lord. Come fill me up, oh Lord. Come fill me up till I overflow. I am so hungry, I am so thirsty. Oh, I must have more of you. I am so hungry, I am so thirsty. Oh, I must have more of you. I am so hungry, I am so thirsty. Oh, I must have more of you. I want more of you, Jesus. I want more.
Lord, we hold nothing back from you. Every part of our being we surrender to you. Lord, we hold on to nothing in this life and nothing in this world that would keep us from being able to see plainly and clearly into the realm in which you exist. We'll hold on to nothing that would keep us, Lord, from interacting with you, receiving from you, representing you, moving with you and in you, Holy Spirit. Here's our lives. Let these be lives, O God, in this place be holy and acceptable unto you, Lord, by the wonderful, precious blood of Jesus. Let everything about our praise, O God, be holy and acceptable unto you, Lord, in your mercy and your grace. Father, move among us in this place tonight in ways that go beyond anything that we've ever experienced. Father, we ask you to do the spectacular. Do the spectacular. Do the spectacular, oh God. The mighty God, the great I am, hallelujah, hallelujah. You are the mighty God, the great I am, hallelujah, hallelujah. You are the mighty God, the great I am. Hallelujah, hallelujah. You are the Alpha and Omega, the beginning and the end, who was and is to come. You are the Alpha and Omega, the beginning and the end, who was and is to come. You are the mighty God, the great I am. Hallelujah, hallelujah.
Hallelujah. You are the mighty God. You are the great I am. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Oh, you are higher than the highest, exalted on high. You're greater than the greatest one. You are exalted higher. You're higher than the highest. You're the greater than the greatest God.
Why don't you put that slide up, will you?
Than you exalted in the heavens. You're higher and lifted up. Your glory fills the heavens and the earth. Oh, you're exalted in the heavens. You're high and lifted up. Your glory fills the heavens and the earth. You are the mighty God. The great I am.
Woo!
Hallelujah! Hallelujah! You are the mighty God. The great I am. Hallelujah! Hallelujah! You are the Alpha and Omega. The beginning and the end, which was and is and is to come. You are the Alpha and Omega, the beginning and the end, who was and is to come.
Could you put the other slide up for us? You're exalted in the heavens. You are high and lifted up.
Your glory fills the heavens and the earth.
Hallelujah.
You are exalted in the heavens. You are high and lifted up. Your glory fills the heavens and the earth. You are the mighty God, the great I am. Hallelujah, hallelujah. You are the mighty God, the great I am. Hallelujah, hallelujah. You are exalted in the heavens. You are high and lifted up. Your glory fills the heavens and the earth. You are exalted in the heavens. You are high and lifted up. Your glory fills the heavens and the earth. You are the Alpha and Omega, the beginning and the end, who was and is to come. You are the Alpha and Omega, the beginning and the end, who was and is to come.
Let me just tell you, you know, as I watch, I'm just watching. With your passion, you enter into another realm. You have a different sound. And one of the beautiful things, dear people, is God's left nobody out of this, and He wants to train you. Maybe your passions have not been ignited with the fire of God yet. But listen, tonight, I'm telling you, tonight, this can be your night. Well, your passions are set on fire of God, the Holy Ghost. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Listen, Father just wants to open up all the dimensions of heaven, that everything that you've seen happen in the Bible, every witness that's ever been, whether it's Enoch, Moses, Elijah, doesn't matter, Daniel, especially the high water mark of Christ Jesus, everything you see happen in the Apostle Peter's life,
Everything you see happening in Paul's life, he wants it to happen in your life. Father wants to give you special anointings. Father has special anointings that he wants to give you. He's given us all the ability, the anointing, and the authority to be sons of God. But there's special anointings Father wants to give you. But you have to reach out and have them and want them and claim them and take hold of them and possess them with a passion and a desire that goes beyond any of your other interests. Amen. So you can be seated. We're going to talk to you about that tonight. Talk to you about that tonight. You know, I just posted on Facebook, and I know I told all of you to stay off of Facebook for 21 days, but you can go to my Facebook. You can go to my Facebook because it's all ministry. Just go to my Facebook. And you will see, I just posted a video of Eddie Aboy teaching on living above the natural. And, you know, it's a beautiful thing. He was announcing to his church, okay, we're going on a fast. It starts January 2nd, ends April the 11th. 100-day fast. Something they do quite regularly and often. Huh? Come on, think about it. 100-day fast. He said, there's a couple of exemptions. If you've just gotten married, you don't have to because you can't go to war. The scripture says, don't let the young married couples go to war. And he said, if you're over 70, you don't need to. But just join in the prayer. He said, now some people may be saying, well, I said over 70 because I'm over 70. He said, no, but he said, I'll tell you what I'm going to do. I'm going to do it all. Because he basically says, if you, during the 100 days, happen to go to a wedding and you eat, then you have to add another day. You have to add 2 days to the 100 days. It's the rules. If you go 21 days and 21 nights with nothing, then that's the same as 63 days. Because it's fast all day and eat at night. If you go 30 days, well, then it's the same as the 100 days, 30 days and 30 nights. He says, so what I'm going to do is I'll do the 30 days and the 30 nights, and I'll continue on throughout the whole course of the 100 days until April 11th. And, you know, he's talking to a church of well over 1 million people sitting out there. And it's the signs and the wonders and the exploits and the miracles. And so I want you to go listen to it because it will help you, those of you who are right now fasting, because you're laying hold on being able to see, being able to hear, and being able to understand what God, the Holy Ghost, has come to cause us to see and hear and know. You're laying hold on the power of God because you want the same exploits of God work through your life as anyone else's life. He was saying, he was talking, and I'll just give you a couple little things, nuggets there. He's talking about when he was first being stirred in the realms of faith, in the realms of the supernatural, and he heard his pastor talking about how when they had a bunch of people gathering in the meeting and that no one had food and they were feeding them, and it was the early days of their ministry. And so they took what they had and they put it in a big soup bowl, and the Lord told them, do not look in the bowl. And so they just you know, stick the ladle in it and just fill everyone's bowl. And this is beautiful because it's something that he didn't say, but I heard so powerfully. The next day, everybody got fed. The next day, they went in, and this time it's beef coming out. Don't look in the bowl. The next day, it was chicken. And it went on and on. And there was people that were in the meeting, that you'll see in the meeting, that were there. They were there. There were people that have been with him since the early days. They were there. They're nodding their heads. They were there. They've watched this. One day, the mama, couldn't take it anymore. She had to look into the bowl. She looked in the bowl and it was completely empty and dry. Where faith reaches in to the realms of the unseen and begins to bring out the visible, the supply to the need. And I mean, he didn't talk about that, but I mean, those are the overtones of what I know about this realm. And people, there is a vast expanse of eternity the Father has made available to us. And there's not a lot of people who have given their life to lay hold on these things. You'll hear miracle after miracle after miracle, signs and wonders after signs and wonders, of where you just said, listen, Lord, you know, they had, when they prayed, the earth was shaken. Well, when I pray, I want the earth to shake too. Amen. And then it started happening. People in the meeting where they were, you know, saying yes, they were there when the foundation cracked from the prayer, where the earthquake was felt
hundreds of miles away. They didn't know where the origin was. Where one day they were in a hotel and they were. What happened was the lead pastor said, I'm getting ready to go home. I'm getting ready to die. I'm turning the ministry over to you. Just speaking to Attaboy. And all of them that were there, the leaders that were there, and there were some of the leaders are there in the meeting. You'll see the camera go on them, you know. We fell down and we began to sob. We just began to sob. And what happened, he had been asking the Lord for a number of years, Lord, I want the earth to shake when I pray. See, claiming, laying hold of it, pursuing it. I want the earth to shake when I pray. Not just one time on just casual prayer and, well, it didn't happen, so you go on with whatever's next on the, you know, agenda. But that persistent, that pursuing, that seeking, that laying hold on the things that God has made available to us, not making them fictional, but making them real. If God's done it in someone else's life, he'll do it in your life. And he said, they just all fell down and began to sob and they began to pray. No, we don't want you to leave. And suddenly a knock comes on the door and it was the engineer of the large hotel. And he says, what instruments, music instruments are you playing in here? They said, we're not playing any music instruments. We're praying. The engineer came in. They walked around. He says, no, you don't understand. This whole building has shaken. They had monitors to tell, and it was here in the United States, this whole building is shaken. And he said, we were just praying. He said, what happened was they shut the whole hotel down. They dug around the hotel trying to figure out what happened, trying to determine the foundation, the damage to the foundation. He said he came back 30 years later. The hotel was still shut down because of the earthquake. He said he felt sorry. He said he felt great compassion. So he walked over, he laid his hand on the hotel building, and he just prayed a silent prayer, a blessing on it. And within 1 year, it was reopened. I mean, supernatural after supernatural, signs and wonders and miracles. That's why there's over a million people there. That's why the church is 1.8 miles by 1.8 miles. It's a building 1.8 miles by 1.8 miles. And it's happening right now. And every sign and every wonder and every demonstration of power and every demonstration of the glory and every demonstration of the presence of God, that's why people are coming. And he, you know what? He's such a model for me because I'm looking at this guy and because I've been listening to him preach. I've been just delving into what's going on in his life. Here he is over 70 years, has all these great exploits, and he's so passionate and he's so hungry. He said, I'm not even anywhere near where I want to be. And this is what he's preaching this year, 2016. I'm not even anywhere near where I want to be. God's purpose that I wave my hand and every person that's blind sees. And every person that's deaf hears. Not just, you know, 1,000 or 10,000 or 100,000. Everyone. He says, I'm just asking the Lord that when my plane sets down in another nation, that everybody within 10 kilometers is immediately healed. And it's already started happening. One day he was praying and said, Lord, you let Paul experience your glory to where the aprons and handkerchiefs was taken from his body. And it was laid on the sick and the devils went out of those that were possessed by them and they were cured. I want that. I've got to have that. I've got to have it. And that's the passion. I've got to have it. It wasn't just pretend. It wasn't just maybe if you can get around to it, I'd like to have that. And by the way, I'm so occupied with the world and all the things that's going on in my life. I'm good. No, I got to have that. And then it began to happen. And one day, the first time it happened, he says it would happen in a radical way that he had heard about because he hadn't actually done anything like that. But he was in a meeting and a woman wanted to see him and wasn't able to see him. So what she did was she grabbed a rag, a cloth that she had, and she ran to the car and she started rubbing on the car with the rag. And there was a girl that was possessed of a devil. She was so insane that it took six men. You'll hear him tell about this. Took six men to hold her down. She's completely insane and wild. And she said, I got the answer. She walked in the room. I got the answer. She's holding up the rag where she shined the car. She laid the rag on the girl, and the girl went, oh, and was immediately whole and in her sound mind. And forever cured. And he goes on to talk about, and he can tell about miracles that happened long, long ago, and how the people are sitting right there in the meeting that those miracles happened to. And he's just talking about, the importance of repenting and being done with sin. He said, our Lord, you gave Elijah the ability to know what was going on in the secret chamber in the bedroom of the king. I want to know. I want to know. I want to know. I want to know. I've got to know. And he's going after this. I don't want to be no normal Christian. And it's beautiful. Because I can feel that. That's the same. And that's why I'm so into it. Because I feel exactly the same thing, you know. And he said, one day, two young women who were just sold out to the Lord Jesus that were in the church came into the office. And he said, you're quarreling. Quit quarreling. He said, no, Pastor, we're not quarreling. He said, you're quarreling. He said, no, we're not quarreling. He said, you're quarreling. He said, no, we're not quarreling. He said, yes, you are. You're quarreling over food. They're going, oh, yeah, but that's because she's constantly burning the food. and now they're back and forth. He said, I told you you're quarreling. You said you weren't quarreling. He said, you can't move on with God quarreling. See, it's coming in this place of perfect obedience. It's not this flippant, you know, anything goes, God still loves us kind of attitude. He does love us. But you can't be so immersed in the world and preoccupied with those things that are bombarding the sense realm right out of really the demonic, right out of the worldly. Even if you would parse it out and you would say it was just purely earthly, it's still holding you back from understanding that God has given to us a supernatural life, the life of the Spirit. We've been born of the Spirit to live in the Spirit. We've been born in the Spirit. We are Spirit, and we constantly want to go back and just and live in a way, in a thinking, in a realm that is just purely earthly. Don't even make it carnal. Just make it purely earthly. You don't want to be seated with Christ in the heavenly realm because of these strongholds and these attachments that grab a hold of you based upon our culture and society. And here we are. I'm not crying out, oh God, what you're doing right now in Nigeria. Do it here. Do it here. I mean, I am so blessed to see God raising up these kind of models. But you understand the environments that God's raising these models up in. Understand the environments that people are really laying hold on God. We're talking about the remote, poor, poverty-stricken, third world countries and or places where it's just, you know, devastating, like, you know, China, where you just don't, or the Middle East, where if you've given your life over to Jesus, there are no opportunities for you. You're just a persecuted minority. You're weird. You're an outcast. You're ostracized. See, it's happening where people have nothing but Him. When you've got a bunch of different things, you've got a bunch of stuff. I pray that you'll stick with the fast. I pray that, you know, some of you, you know, you got to fast. You got to work so, you know, you can, maybe you got to, you know, you can only fast through the day and eat at night or whatever. Stick with it. Because if you've never done this, you do not know what you're missing. You don't know what you're missing. We can plead with you and we can beg you. And maybe some of you have only done 1 or 2 day fasts. Those are okay. But you don't know what you're missing. When you begin to live above the natural. Yeah. See, fleshly lusts come out to war against us, to steal from us everything that God has given to us. Satan hates the anointing. The anointing, he has no power to withstand it. And Father wants His glory to so rise up on the inside of us that all of His enemies are scattered, that His glory of His light of His presence begin to shine through us. But we've got to want that more than anything else. We've got to start, quit acting like we don't deserve it. You don't deserve nothing. You don't even deserve to breathe. So get off the deserve train. You deserve eternity. And, you know, if you're going to I don't deserve it thing, just go ahead and be in hell. Because that's all you deserve. But God in His love and His mercy gave to us His love. Gave to us His righteousness. Gave to us His holiness. Gave to us heirship and inheritance in Him. Gave to us all that He Himself possesses. Gave the Holy Spirit so that we'll be able to see that all the Father has is ours. Gave us the Holy Spirit so He could teach us so that we can begin to understand that we don't live by the five senses, that we can see what eyes haven't seen, that we can see now in the spiritual. Just as Elijah said concerning his servant, open up his eyes. His servant wasn't blind naturally. His servant was blind spiritually. And as soon as his servant's eyes were open, he saw the angels of the Lord. He saw the horses of the Lord, the chariots of the Lord, and the armies of God filling up everything around them, all that belongs to heaven. And all you and I got to do is get real with God. But all the stuff that you just condescend to and coalesce with, you just give yourself over to. And you just sit there and you allow this other input, these other things to satisfy you. No. we want you to come and drink of this realm of heaven. We want you to come and taste and see that it is good. And let God begin to fill you, and just go ahead and begin to lay hold on the supernatural supply of heaven. That's what makes a difference. A man or a woman steps up in a generation and they, with total abandonment, go after God and forget about everything else, no matter what it costs, no matter what the price is. And then they step over into that realm of interacting and knowing how to move with the Holy Ghost that they've been born into, knowing how to move with the Spirit of the Lord, knowing how to function in that which God has freely given. And it changes everything. All of a sudden, miracles, signs and wonders begin to happen. A great sweeping of the power of God suddenly begins to overwhelm cities and regions and states and nation. And I'm just encouraging tonight. Listen, God has what He's done for one person to do for you. Yeah. He's no respecter of persons. All you got to do is want it. And it can't just be a little whimsical idea. Well, you know, I'd kind of like to have that. Let me just go after and pray for a while. And then at the first little, you know, moment of seeming defeat, or it didn't work out the way you thought it should work out, you give up. Well, what is that? That's a seed that's on stony. That's the seed of God's word on stony ground. As soon as a little persecution, as soon as a little opposition rises, what do? You wither away. You say, oh, well, it wasn't real. No, now you're making God a liar. Now you're saying somehow you're trying to reinvent what God said in His Word. And of course, there's a lot of people who agree with you around there. God, I mean, Satan has set up a whole lot of religious adversaries against the anointing of the Holy Ghost. I want you to think about this. I want you to think about this with me. Think about this with me. You ready? The church was purchased with the blood of Jesus. The church. Jesus Christ is a temple builder. He's the temple builder of Zechariah chapter 6. He's the temple builder. He's not waiting to build His temple in the future. He will build a temple in the future. He will build a millennial temple in the future. There's no doubt about it. But He's already built His temple, His church. Okay? He laid the foundation of it, the apostles and the prophets. He's the chief cornerstone. He's the builder. He's building up a holy habitation that you and I are a part of, this holy temple in the Lord, this tabernacle of praise, that He's baptized in the Holy Ghost and fire. Think about it. He's purchased it with His own blood. He's baptized it in the Holy Ghost and fire. It is the fullness of Him that fills all things. Are you with me? Yes. We're letting it be something else. We're willing to stand by. It's time for the valiant to arise. We're willing to stand by and allow it to be something else. We're more living according to our own will and to our own desires and our own plans and what makes us feel good and what we feel comfortable with, rather than pressing in to lay hold on the will of the Father. He purchased it with His own blood. He baptized it in the Holy Ghost and fire. It is the fullness of Him that filleth all things. If you need the scriptures that I'm quoting, I'm happy to give them to you. I'm sure all of you know them because your heart is passionate about these things. The church is literally the personified person of Jesus revealed in the earth. It's His body, in other words. It's filled with all the splendor and activity of the working of the Holy Ghost. It's the vehicle of His kingdom. It's the light that shines bright like a city set upon a hill. Well, we got to step back and say, wait a minute. Have I been willing to coalesce or cooperate with something less than that? Have I been willing to have my own ideas about what church is like? A place to serve coffee and have donuts and a little Bible study and everybody basically does whatever it is that they do? Or is it the place where all God's glory and power and splendor is being revealed? So we're going to get into this a little bit tonight. I want you to open your Bibles with me to 1 Corinthians chapter 2. And I want you to recognize that God has special anointings that He wants you to begin to function in. I want this to be the whole context of what, when I begin to minister, what you're thinking. There's special anointings. Anything that anybody's ever done, you can do it. Jesus Christ was the sum total of every miracle, every sign and wonder, every manifestation of the power and the glory of God. And He said, I want you to do greater works than I've done. So anything that anybody did, you can have that. So if Elijah did it, you can have it. If Elisha did it, you can have it. If Daniel did it, you can have it. Amen. If the Apostle Paul did it, you can have it. Amen. If Peter did it, you can have it. Anything, anybody ever did. If Enoch did it, you can do it.
Amen.
Because God's not a respecter of a person, but he demands hunger and thirsting. He demands passion because it's sacred. It's holy. Let me just tell you this story just before I move in to say this because, you know, and I don't want to scare anybody, but I want to just tell you the heart of the Father. Because it's revealed here. Because he's going to allow you to press in because you're willing. He sees you. He sees you. You're saying no to sin. You're saying no to the things of the world. You want him. You want him above everything else. You're laying hold on the purity, not the synthetic, not the fake, the purity of the real thing that God gives. Not some familiar spirit, his spirit. Not some, you know, lying sign and wonder, his signs and wonders. One day, Eddie Boy was fasting as he fasts often. And he was up laying hold on God, and he had an encounter with God, an amazing encounter with God. Amazing things. Amazing things. The glorious appearings of the Lord Jesus Christ. And this was before he actually had the great breakthrough of all the signs and wonders and the miracles on the level. He would have signs and wonders and miracles, but on the level that it ultimately resulted in a church that's 1.8 miles long and 1.8 miles wide. And after the encounter he had with the Lord, and the Lord had imparted some things to him, he said, draw a picture in the sand of a stick man. And he's standing there talking to the Lord. First the Lord showed him and said some things. He said, that's the way people perceive you. And he built a building, and he said, He made a little, you know, little drawing of the building. He said, this is the way men perceive you. And he was seeing it in a vision. He said, no, just erase it. Men will not see you that way anymore. Just take your hand in the sand and erase it. So he did. He erased it. He said, now draw a little stick man in the sand. And he did. He said, now reach forth your hand and erase it. He said, that's what I will do to you if you profane my glory. See, there's not a lot of people that are willing to step into that. There's not a lot of people that are willing to go just on basic test every day to say, are you going to do it God's way or your way? To ultimately step into a realm where the Apostle Paul stepped. Because it's a realm. It's a realm. Some people say, well, no, it's just for, you know, there's different, you know, different assignments for different people. And there's certain ways that you can prove that pre-new covenant. In other words, you could say, well, look at John the Baptist. He had a different assignment than Jesus. He didn't do any signs and wonders and miracles. He just preached, and it was great Holy Ghost conviction. See, he had a different assignment. That's pre-new covenant. All of a sudden, when Christ Jesus comes on the scene, he says, there's only one ministry. You can't have any other ministry but my ministry. That's it. Yep. People want other kinds of ministries. They want different kinds of assignments. He said, no, there's only one assignment. There's only one life. There's not different kinds of life. There's not various different, you know, fragments of my life. It's just me or nothing. And everything that I have, I give to you. And anybody who believes these works, shall they do in greater works. But there's always God looking to be able to prepare us into every good work. And there's not a lot of people that want to be prepared, especially in the Western world, because you've got lots of opportunities. Man, you could be a billionaire. People go after that. They spend their whole life trying to become a millionaire or a billionaire or whatever. Oh, you could be famous. And you got all these people, you know, with a guitar in a garage trying to become famous. Oh, you can become a movie star. And you got all these people, you know, doing drama in their own mirror or whatever. And this, their whole life is living a fantasy and living a lie and living something about that's purely earthly and has nothing to do with reality. And worse than that is purely demonic. It's just an illusion. It's just a deception. And then the Lord, you know, reaches out and he grabbed a hold of you and you responded and you're here tonight and you were here last night. And you're seeking the Lord and you want to break past those barriers. And I tell you right now, I'm hooked up with you. Because I want you to break past those barriers too, and I want to break past every barrier. I mean, the barriers, the limitation and barriers called doubt and unbelief. The limitation and the barrier is called fear and worry and concern and intimidation. Those are barriers. Well, if I step out and I trust God like that, we're going to all die and starve to death, or whatever. I mean, if I step out and we fast 100 days, then we're all going to have bad health for the rest of our lives. You know, whatever, those kinds of things that begin to lay siege on your emotions and your thoughts, where you can never really walk after God. You're never willing to really go where He wants to lead you. At some place in time, there's got to be a total abandonment where God says, no, I don't want you to fill yourself with all of that stuff. Because all it's doing is drawing you away from me. It's keeping you from being able to hear my voice. It's keeping you from being able to see into the realm, because your senses are filled with everything that literally was designed to blind you. Your senses are being filled with everything that was literally designed in the demonic realm to deafen you. And this way, the Lord says that if we purify ourselves or purge ourselves from these things, then we'll be found vessels of honor, prepared unto every good work. To purge yourself from all of the worldly stuff, all of the religious stuff, all the philosophical stuff. And I'm telling you right now, in the United States of America, people, you and I are getting contaminated and polluted with more philosophy and ideology within the ranks of Christianity than any. I mean, it's no exception to the rule. And people are then now designing a God and fashioning a God after their own liking. Well, I like God better now when I think of Him like this. You know, some people, it's like I said the other night, you know, what do you got to do how does God got to change so you will like Him more? And I said to you that many people would just like a God who doesn't expect an offering. If we could just get Him to no longer expect us to give our finances into the offering basket, we would like Him a whole lot more. We'd be a lot more comfortable with Him. And there's a whole gamut and a whole list and a whole plethora of things that people have in their attitudes and in their disposition. And it's really the makings of your condemnation. It's the makings of your shame. It's the making of your disobedience. Because that's all the areas that God expects and wants of you that you don't like. And that you would like Him better if He didn't expect that anymore. But that is a completely warped view of God and a realm of deception. Everything that He's asked of us because He wants to bring us out of the realms of darkness into His light. Everything that He's asked of us is because He wants to bring us out of the strife and the quarrel and the argument over into His peace and His love and His goodness. Everything that He's asked of us is about living in a place where we can receive all the abundance that He supplies. He doesn't want us to be imprisoned and held back by the powers of darkness, to have a boundary set upon us because our own will chose to participate in some dimension with those that are rebels against Him, that are completely shut off from all that He wants to freely give. That's part of what fasting and praying is all about. Fasting is about living above the natural. Amen. Fasting is about moving out of those things which natural earthly appetites demand of us. Fasting is about, it goes beyond all of that though. It is an actual spiritual activity that is a supernatural thing. When it's in Christ Jesus, when it's given over to the power of the Holy Ghost, because the Muslims fast Ramadan. They fast for 1 month every year, 30 days. They just eat at night. It doesn't do them any good. Because it has nothing to do with reality. It's not in the realms of the faith. It's not in the realms of seeking God the way that Father has told us to seek Him. When we seek Him, I'm going to tell you right now, we're going to find Him. We're going to get rewarded by Him. And what is the reward? The reward is all those things that belong to His presence, to His glory, to His person. The reward is being able to be ambassadors of the heavenly realm, to be those people who walk in the glory that Christ Jesus manifested when He was revealed to destroy the works of the devil. And now He's being made manifest and revealed in me and in you. And we come to a place where we just demand it. Jesus, I demand it. I've got to have You being revealed in my life. Not just some little plastic Jesus on a dashboard, but the real, genuine Jesus of signs, wonders, and miracles. No, not just some kind of iconic Jesus that people believe lived 2,000 years ago, but the one who's King of Kings and Lord of Lords, who has all power and authority over all the realms of darkness. And you got to understand that there's spiritual wickedness that wars against us. They war against us with fleshly lust. They war against us with the lust of the flesh, the lust of the eye, and the pride of life. And there are so many things around you that is designed by the satanic realm to hook you into those things. Those things, literally, understand it, they war against your soul, and they prevent you from being able to freely receive all that He's freely given to function in the heavenly realm. And so, fasting, as you begin to fast, it begins to develop not only that much more of a resolve and a consecration and a commitment of your will to do the will of the Father, but you find yourself now stepping into a whole other dimension of prayer, where prayer just flows. Where prayer becomes prophetic, it becomes the utterances of God. Hallelujah. Where it becomes revelatory. I remember when early in my life in ministry, you know, I'd given myself to, you know, coming up with a sermon, you know, the usual ways. And then through fasting and prayer, I found myself now coming into a place of prayer where all of my sermons were prayed out. I would just take notes while I was praying. I discovered that when I went to the room to pray, that all of these things just was revelatory, started coming out of my mouth. So, and I wanted to capture them, but I just, you know, was so captivated by the flow. Listen, you get into fasting, I'm telling you right now, understand this, you won't want to stop. It gets too good. Yeah, you get the hunger pains, but big deal. The spiritual dynamics of the glory of heaven being revealed in your soul is far bigger than the hunger pains. Big deal for the hunger pains. But you just basically, you know, I know what it's like to start off with in your whole realm, your whole human existence is captivated by your stomach. I understand that. I went through that thing. Your whole human existence is about your stomach. And when your stomach roars, when the beast roars, you feed it. But then all of a sudden you begin to move into a place where, wait a second, I'm drinking of water. I'm drinking. I've got some meat that I knew not of. I got some food I knew not of before. I've got some drink that's drink indeed that I didn't know anything about. I'm experiencing some interaction, some ease of stepping over into prayer, stepping over into the manifest presence of God, stepping over into the utterances of the Lord that before I never understood. I like this. Somebody said you can't fast all the time. I tell you right now, fasting will change you for the rest of your life. It will. It will cause you to begin to lay hold on things in God. It will cause you to enter into new dimensions in God. Because there's spiritual dynamics of your own will coming to bear and God's working it out. And I can't explain it all to you. And if I, because I don't understand it all. And if I could explain it all, you wouldn't understand it either. So just go ahead and participate with the miracles of God. You don't understand where the wind blows from. You don't understand where the wind's coming from and where it's going. People always want to try to explain how God the Holy Ghost is going to do it. As soon as they start explaining, go ahead and you can now read your Bible. Because you can't move with God like that. It isn't going to be based on logic, based on your own understanding. It's going to be based on the reality that you discerned His movings and you're able, as it were, to put up the cell of your life and let God, the Holy Spirit, move you. And if we'll let God, Holy Spirit, move us, He'll move us into the effectual, fervent prayer that goes way beyond what Elijah had. Elijah had effectual, fervent prayer, not because he was such a bright human being when he was born, but because he received an anointing from heaven. He had a divine gifting and ability to do that. You want these things, you've got to lay hold on them. They've got to become more important to you than anything else. And this is rare. It's rare. Oh, but what if it was common in this house? What if it became common in this house? Yeah. It doesn't matter what price there is to pay. I want these things. I want to have it in my life. Amen. Thank you, Lord Jesus. Did you get that fixed yet? I'll continue to hold this. Thank you, Jesus. Could you open your Bibles with me, 1 Corinthians chapter 2? Did you already do that? Yeah. Hallelujah. This sounds so good. This sounds so staticky. but we'll just go with the static for a while so I can open up my Bible. Are you there?
Yeah.
There's some things that, you know, I love looking at people's lives and studying their lives and delving into what it is that they're saying and understanding, you know, I want to be around the Apostle Paul when he's preaching so I can begin to minister like him and understand how the ministry is supposed to work. I want to be around the Lord Jesus Christ so that I can minister like him, understand how the ministry is supposed to work. And what happens is as you do that, the Lord shows you all of your issues. All of your complaints, all the things you like and don't like, all the things that are about you, all of your behaviorism, all of your mannerism that you're trying to bring to the table. That's literally shutting down the move of the Holy Ghost. This shutting down the exploits of heaven. He shows us our doubts. Once again, he shows us our unbeliefs. He shows to us our fears, our intimidation. Oh no, there's all these eyes looking at me right now. All the self-consciousness, all of that stuff. That keeps us back from moving in the beauty of all that Father has supplied. Oh, Father wants to shake this place tonight. Can you imagine that we just go to prayer and all of a sudden that prayer becomes effective as we begin to cry out to God and ask Him to stretch forth His hand and grant signs and wonders by His holy child Jesus, and suddenly the place is shaken and all of the seismographs begin to go off the Richter scale and they're saying, my goodness, it looks like the epicenter is at 9850 Carroll Canyon Road right there in San Diego. And it was felt all the way, you know, on the East Coast kind of thing. Now the Lord's going to do it again. One of my relatives in 16 was right. It was right around 1630. It was in the 1660s. I think it's 1667, right around there. They were in a place up in Rhode Island, and there was about four or five of them, and this is historic. It's historic in government documents. It's historic in church documents, and they begin to pray. They begin to cry out to God for signs and wonders and miracles in the colonies, and while they were praying, it was literally on Sunday, Pentecost Sunday. It was on Pentecost Sunday, in 16. And I'm pretty sure this is the correct date, 67. You can look it up. It's you could Google this stuff even. And there was an earthquake. I think it's the strongest recorded or by history and the way that they did it. It was the and the way that they back calculate these things, which I don't fully understand, the strongest recorded earthquake in the East Coast in the history of recording earthquakes. Pretty amazing, eh? Now, people could say, well, it just happened because this and that and the other was a coincidence. No, it happened because they were praying, crying out for God to stretch forth His hand to grant signs and wonders by His holy child, Jesus. And there was just four or five people there in that little prayer meeting. And they've actually built a park and a monument. And literally, there is a monument there set where they prayed to this day. Pretty radical, huh? Yeah. Amazing, 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 amazing. And if we could just begin to really believe that, if we could move past all of the stuff that has captivated our attention that causes us not to believe it, that we don't even realize that we've made those compromises because we watched too many movies, because we heard too many philosophical ideologies, because we're captivated in our interests and in our passions in a whole nother realm that is so earthly and so temporal that it isn't going to even last your lifetime. And you are so temporal. Father wants to move us from the temporalness, the temporality, over into the vast expanse of His eternity.
Amen.
That's taking in a firm grip on eternal life, His life. Not some religious life, not some little notions of denominationalism, but what Jesus Himself demonstrated. What everybody in the book of Acts demonstrated. What the Church of the Lord Jesus Christ is viewed to be in the New Covenant, not some new definition. New definition is powerless. It has a profession of God, but it denies the power of it. It has a form of godliness, but doesn't have the power. So Paul says here in 1 Corinthians chapter 2, see if I can get over there quickly. And I want you to say, okay, this is the way I'm going to be. This is the way I'm going to. This is the way I'm going to minister. This is the way I'm going to live. Because he's not just talking about, first and foremost, he's not just talking about his ministry in the church. He's talking about his life. It is living out the life of Jesus is not something that we do on Sundays and Wednesdays. It's a lifestyle. It's who we are.
Amen.
Amen. And suddenly you make a transition, and you're not a banker anymore. Or you're not a lawyer anymore. Or you're not a doctor anymore. Or you're not a garbage man anymore. Ha ha. But I tell you right now, a doctor is a bigger laugh than the garbage man. And the lawyer is probably even a bigger laugh than both of them to put together. I mean, when you pare it all down, and the deception and all the stuff that goes on and the idolatry that is in it and the falsehoods that's in it. And who are you? What do you do? And as soon as somebody says, who are you? What do? You're starting to tell them how you make money and how you fit into society and how you're a good citizen and how you're a mechanic or you're a carpenter or, you know, you start bragging on yourself about how long you've been doing it. And yeah, we're the best that's ever been. The identity, an identity crisis. True. Oh, I sell donuts from house to house. You wouldn't brag on that. I sell insurance. I sell this, or I, you know, all these things that we describe ourselves to be. How about all of a sudden, if we become the representatives of the kingdom of God?
Amen.
How about all of a sudden, somebody says, "What do? You now have a divine revelation. You speak out of the realms of the spirit, and it is specific to their need, and it's an identity that you have specifically in Christ Jesus of who you are as a new creature, as a son of God, as a man of God, or as a woman of God. As a minister of the gospel, as an ambassador of heaven.
Yeah.
What do? I'm an ambassador of heaven. You're what? Well, you don't want to tell anybody that. Why? Because they're going to think you're weird, okay? Yeah. The Father says, yeah, that's great. That's who you are. But you're more interested in pleasing people than pleasing Him. What people, God's unseen, they're seen. And I really want them to like me or think I'm cool. But I'm going to tell you right now, let me pop your bubble. They're not going to like you and they're not going to think you're cool. They may smile at you, and you may be able to have some common things to talk about, but what does that profit you? What did that profit them? And what value does that have in reality? What value does that have spiritually? What difference is that going to make about their eternity?
Amen.
I think it would be a great thing if God's people just start really believing in heaven and hell.
Amen.
People say that they believe in heaven, but they don't believe in hell. They don't really believe in heaven. Because if someone who talked about heaven talked more about hell than he talked about heaven. And so all of a sudden we have all these indications that tell us, wait a minute, we really are prisoners of unbelief and doubt. We really are more concerned about what men think of us rather than what God thinks of us. Because it's going to be very difficult for you to start saying, I am a man of God. I am an ambassador of heaven. When somebody just told you that they were, you know, a gardener or they a landscaper or whatever, and they were expecting you now to, you know, say something that they can relate to, and now you're going to say something that they can't relate to, and they're going to think you're totally weird, and you're going to blow the whole opportunity to be what and do what? I mean, have you thought it through? Somebody said to me, they said, what are you going to do about your bad breath during fasting? I said, you're going to have mints if you care, but I really don't care. Father's happy with my bad breath.
Amen.
You know, you can just stand back a couple of feet away from me. Sorry. Mine's probably really bad right now. First couple of days it's bad, and then it turns sweet. It's amazing. It's a biological thing that's happening. It's a biochemical thing that's happening in your life, in your body, according to science. But it's just something that God has designed according to heaven. You're starting to get sweet now. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Praise God.
Thank you.
Praise God. I pray that every one of you are fasting and praying with me. I pray that you understand that you can go into a realm where prayer will become continuous, it will become instant, and it won't be just imaginations of your thoughts, but it'll be supernatural power. It'll be dimensions. It will be dimensions of supernatural inspiration, supernatural strength. You're like, where do you get the strength from? Supernatural. It's totally supernatural. Where do you get the energy from? Totally supernatural. It's the grace of God. I noticed some of you, when you first start fasting, all you can do is lay on a bed and groan. Why? Because that's been your whole world. It's been your whole world. I mean, think about it. You live to eat kind of thing. You know, breakfast, snacks, lunch. Huh? Second lunch. I mean, I was with some people, and it's like, you talk about first breakfast and second breakfast and third breakfast. These guys had it going on. You know, I had breakfast, and then they went to the bagel shop, and they were going to have breakfast again. I said, look, I've already had breakfast. Oh, no, I've had breakfast. But it just goes on and on all day long. Now we're going to stop at, you know, this coffee shop, and we're going to get, a triple Carmiato mocha with sprinkles and, on and on. And then the next thing you know, we're stopping again for something else. You know, it's just like, you gotta be kidding me. Yes, you will lay on the bed and groan. Because it's your whole life. It's your whole life. What happens if suddenly we find something that's more important than our food? So what happens if all of a sudden we begin to touch something that the Lord's saying, he's giving us a clue, and he's saying, take no thought for what you shall eat. That's rare. That's rare. Don't concern yourself with your clothing. I want to begin to reveal myself to you. I want to reveal myself to you that I am not only the Redeemer, I am the Provider. I'm not only your Provider, I'm your Protector. I mean, you don't need a gun when you got the sun. I mean, I am the one that has all, that will supply all that you have need of according to my riches and glory. And that isn't just a scripture anymore. That isn't just an idea. It's something that you now are able to move in and receive out of, because the Word has become living Word, supernatural faith. Your eyes have been open to see in the realms of the Spirit. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah. I was reminded of something today when Adduboy was talking about, he's just crying out to God, Lord, I want to be able to see. Elijah was able to see. I want to be able to see. He's going through the list of all everybody could see. You know, Peter knew when Ananias and Sapphira was lying. I want to know. He's going through all these things. And he said, and he describes how when he first had the open vision, where all of a sudden it came up before him. He was looking at a door, and this door all of a sudden became a screen. And in the screen, he saw a man kneeling down in the vestibule, praying, crying out to God, laying hold on the anointing. But then opened the door, and he came out of the door, and he walked to the pulpit. And as soon as he began to preach, the fire and the presence and the power of God began to fall supernaturally in amazing ways, and people began to be saved by the thousands. And he comes and he tells his pastor that. And his pastor grabbed his head when he was telling him. He said, oh no, I'm in trouble now. My pastor just grabbed his head like, this guy's a nutcase. And he said, and he called the elders of the church. He said, tell them what you just told me. And he told them, and he said, listen, what you described is what we were dedicated to doing for years, and we stopped doing it. And the same glory and the same power that was manifested in the meetings back in those days have not been manifested since. They all repented, got right with God, and started doing what God demanded. Somebody said, well, you really need to do that? Is it an obligation? No, it's a relationship. It's Father calling us into a place so that we're able to hear. You want to hear? Then you need to come to a place where you can hear. He wants to create within you the hearing. Now, you've got to want this more than anything else. Imagine if you're deaf, how desperate you would be about hearing. And then all of a sudden, someone says to you, I'll give you the ability to hear, but you've got to come over here, and you've got to do these certain things. You've got to be a part of what I'm doing, and you'll be able to hear. God says the same thing to us about seeing. He says the same thing to us about knowing. But what we do is we'll continually hear these things, and it doesn't stir within our spirit a passion and a hunger. It just for a moment we're excited about it, and then we're prisoners of our culture, and we're trapped into our everyday lifestyle. That's another thing that fasting will do for you, and it's why it's wonderful to do it the first of the year, because it all of a sudden exposes your traps and your lifestyles and your routines, because now it's, everything's interrupted. You're not eating. Your whole life is, you're not eating. And you're not involved in anything secular. You're not listening to the TV. You're not listening to the radio. You're not involved in anything secular. You're just giving completely over to talking to Father, to telling Him how you feel about Him, telling Him about what you want in your life, telling Him about the things that you're needing, telling Him about your desire to know Him and walk with Him. It's just all about Him. You separate yourself from everything earthly and everything sensual and everything worldly. Sue, who was it here that was talking about the book by Hall on fasting? I think it was Tim Hall who was here. Well, of course, Hall said you're not even supposed to take a shower. He was radical. I tried that to start off with. Whew. He was radical. He was radical. I think Tim mentioned how radical he was. But I'm telling you right now, when you're desperate, you're going to go for it. Yeah. You just think that it's just by accident that you begin to move in faith and you begin to move in anointing. You begin to move in a passion. You begin to move in the authorities of God. You begin to grow in hunger. It's not by accident. It's by participation. Yeah. It's by participation. Everybody starts in the same cloud of doubt. Everybody starts in the same place of separation from God. And Father steps in with His love and with His grace. And He draws us unto Himself. And if we'll just participate and respond, He'll come upon us and He'll create a brand new thing. And this brand new thing is born of the Spirit, to live in the Spirit. Having been born of the Spirit, we are Spirit. And God is Spirit. That's who He is. And that's supposed to be the whole identity of our life and the place and the center of our desires. We want supernatural stuff. We want signs and wonders and miracles. We love the love. We love the joy, the humility, the brokenness, the peace, the purity, the godliness, the Spirit of the Son crying out in us, oh God, everything about you, you're my Father, and I want to be just like you, Dad. But something happens along the way. Religion is a trap. Religion is a ditch. And many people have fallen into that ditch. And down in that ditch, they're counseling you and telling you that you shouldn't be, don't worry about it, you're going to be just like everybody else. There's no difference. You're in the human condition, and this is the way it is. And hey, by the way, let's go get involved in some other nonsense. That it's all it's going to do is shut you down from being able to move in a greater dimension of faith, because it's literally fellowshipping with doubt and unbelief. It's fellowshipping with fear and intimidation. It's fellowshipping with darkness. You're not going to develop a sense realm to be able to know what God's doing when you're with the opposite spirit. Hello. So let's look at how Paul, one of the places where he zeroes in on how he functions in the anointing, okay? We know that we can read in Romans 15, 19, and how that Paul said that I fully preach the gospel with signs and wonders and the power of the Holy Ghost from Jerusalem to Illyricum. I got to have that. I want the same thing, Father. I want to be able to fully preach the gospel. I'm fully preaching the gospel with mighty signs and wonders and the demonstration of the Holy Ghost and power. I know He hears me right now. There was not too many years ago that I could say that and I didn't know He heard me. I believed He heard me. What's going to make the difference? Walking with Him. Spending time with Him. Fasting and praying. It's going to make the difference. I heard all my life. You want to have great faith? You have to have a great prayer life. You want a great prayer life? You have to have a great fasting life. Well, people don't want to do that. Well, that doesn't make any sense to me. I tell you right now, nothing makes sense to you, really. You just deceived yourself to believe that you understand it. Holla. Come on. Come on, people. Quit being so high-minded. It's one of the most important things. Listen, just simply obey God. Cooperate with Him. Why do you fast? Because Jesus fasted. And look at the results He had. That is logic enough. That is explanation enough. Because Paul fasted, and look at the results he had. What did Paul say about fasting? Seldom. Thank you. He said often. One person all the way in the back caught it. And is going to be zealous for the word of the Lord. Thank you. And God caused that zeal to be passionately revealed with His glory and His presence throughout the earth in Jesus' name. Fasting's often. I mean, Jesus looked at the Pharisees and he said, unless your righteousness exceed the righteousness of the Pharisees, you're going to go to hell too. That's what he said. And when the primary products of their righteousness was that they fasted two times a week. So I said, okay, I'll fast three. And I lived my life that way for a while. Eat a day, fast a day, eat a day, fast a day. Saturdays, fast. Always fast. Sundays, fast. Why? Because I want to grab a hold of this. I'm certain that if I didn't have all the religious baggage, because I was raised in church, if I didn't have all the religious baggage and nonsense that I had to work through, I'd have gotten there. You know, I'd have been able to receive what God wanted to freely give me a lot sooner. The most bogged down people raised in church. That's unfortunate. It shouldn't be that way, and it doesn't have to be that way, because it's not that way in my kid's life. Praise God. Hallelujah. Amen. Hallelujah. And I'm telling you right now, if there's something going on in their life, we'll dream about it. Say, hey, what's going on now? Huh? We'll get that straight. Now, let me hear you pray. You know, when they were 5 or 6 years old, I said, every one of you pray in the Holy Ghost right now. I said, I want you guys to pray. They started praying. And then I said, that is pathetic. Let's get some real prayer going on here now. Okay, I was more interested in that than their math. I didn't mentor them in math. I didn't mentor them in science. I didn't mentor them in history. I mentored them in Holy Ghost. Amen. Where's your value system? That's really important. You don't know it, but your deeds are always revealing to you what really is going on inside of you. Your actions, your behavior, what's coming out of your mouth. It's always revealing what's really going on inside of you. And I tell you right now, if you don't like what's going on inside of you, cry out to God and let Him change you. Hallelujah. And you know what? There's people who have come into the real change of God, but they weren't willing to walk with God. They conformed to the world. They were radically changed. They had the opportunity to conform to Christ, Jesus, to take all that He's freely given and see themselves functioning in His authority and His power as His heirs and co-inheritors of God. To take all the dimensions of this wonderful glory that He's freely given. But what happened is they didn't conform to the image. They conformed to the world. They conformed to the world system. I understand. Everybody's lost the definition of worldliness. I understand that. What I have to do now is give you a word that you do understand. Secular. Hello? Secular. You know, I'm going to say this. I want to go off on this because it's important. It's important you understand. I love, you know, my book's getting ready to be published, and I need help. I need help for it to go the way that Father wants it to go, and He wants it to go big, and everybody's prophesying over this, and I'm not going to let the enemy. I've had a lot of people prophesy over things, and the enemy's just been able to get in there and shut it down, and I'm ready. It's time, and I'm learning more about going to war. I've learned more about going to war so that Satan cannot shut it down. Huh? And I just praise God that the Father's raising up people to go to war with me. I can hear it in I can hear it in your prayers. I can hear it in the cry. Yeah. But, you know, Israel, people are always talking about, oh, they're going to build a temple in Israel, right? Because everybody wants a temple built so Jesus can come. Amen. And so do I. I want Jesus to come, but I don't need a temple built for Jesus to come. Are you with me? But nonetheless, everybody's talking about the temple being built. Temple's not going to be built. Not now. Why? Because Israel is a secular nation. It's not a religious nation. And they don't want to be a religious nation. They're 80% secular. That's the truth. I have had that verified over and again. Not only did I do research on it, but I've actually sat down and talked with Israelis. So, do you want a temple? Are you kidding me, man? We don't want to be like Iran. We want to be a religious nation. We're a secular nation. If there's a temple, man, the Hasidics and the Haredi are completely out of control as it is. Get a temple, my goodness, and they'll run us all out of town. You know, none of us will be able to move. And the list goes on. So reality of it is secular is really the opposite of what God's doing. And I just use that as just one example, give you a prophetic insight to things that have still got to happen yet before things are going to be developed for it all the pieces to be in place. But I really want to contrast secular. And I don't really want to count. I hate contrasting it with religious. But that is the contrast. And for you and me, secular is the contrast of being in the presence of God and interacting with Father and being captivated by all the things that He says He wants for us, that He's decreed, that He said that He's created us to be, to not be conformed, to live our lives as a living sacrifice, something that is holy and acceptable, this hand-picked, perfect offering that is well-pleasing in His sight and is just burning there in His presence with His glory, and He's delighting in it. And that's who we live. That's how we live. And not being conformed to the world, but being transfigured by thinking different about ourselves, by having a different way of thinking, having the thoughts that God has declared to us. Being the people that God says we are, being vested with His authority, vested with His power, being His sons and daughters, and being proud of it, not ashamed.
Well, I'm a Christian. Oh, I'm a son of God.
When's the last time you told somebody you were a son of God? We would be going, you wouldn't believe what happened to me. I'm a son of God now. just that we should be really excited about it and proud and just shocked. And, you know, it doesn't matter what people think. They're stupid anyways. Everybody's not thinking anyways. They're all deceived anyways. They're living vicariously. They like to sit and watch TV all day. It's just, you talk about living a vicarious, nonsensical life. Come on, think about it, people. You get up, you go to work. You have people completely dissatisfied with your work continually. You're trying to get them satisfied so that you can get a raise, so that you get a promotion, hopefully get a better job. And you go home and you eat something and you do whatever, and then you go to bed, you get back up and you do it again. It's Samson with his eyes plucked out, his hair cut off, grinding Philistines, going round and round and round and round. Doing the work of a donkey. Lord Jesus. And we got identity in that? Come on, people. Come on, why don't we just start doing signs and wonders? Yeah. Why don't we walk into the house or into the workplace or into the store and say, hey, I'm the signs and wonders person. Do you need any signs and wonders? Well, they're gonna think I'm crazy. Or just walk into the place just with a big smile on your face. Just saying hi to people. They're going to be freaking out over that. Yeah. Just being nice, being kind to people. We discovered that there's certain places in the world, actually everywhere, that all you got to do is walk down the street with a big smile on your face saying hi. And before long, people are going to say, what is going on with you? What's happening? That's all you got to do to be able to really be effective in ministry. And people are going to come up to you right, left, and center. Somebody said, if you've got a dog, people are going to constantly come up to you. If you've got a smile, they're going to come up to you. And that's really a good place to start, because so many people are under the influence of the powers of darkness and they don't even know it, and that's why they're sad and sorrowful and depressed. That is an influence of the spiritual powers of darkness, the prince and the power of the air, imposing upon you. And Father wants to show you how to break free of that so you're not restricted from living in the happy, living in the joy, living in the good things. To wake up in the morning and you don't need coffee, you're just already like happy. Father, you're so good. Just find yourself walking around with all of the problems and all the issues coming at you right, left, and center, and you're just like bubbling up inside with joy. Huh? And people are like, I'm looking at you weird. They just gave you some more bad news, and you're just like, you can't help it, you're just smiling. But do you know something I don't know? I just gave you some bad news. You know something I don't know? Yeah. Well, what? He supplies all my needs according to his riches and glory. My provider is God Almighty. He's a sovereign God. And I wasn't happy to just be thinking about that right now. I just got the bubble up of joy. But seeing as you asked, let me tell you where the bubble up of joy comes. Let me tell you where this wonderful peace comes that rules me. I've got something ruling me, ruling my heart and ruling my mind, because I'm willing to simply say yes to God and do it his way. I'm willing to cooperate with them. I'm willing to answer in humility and not out of self-defense. I'm willing to love when people hate me. I'm willing to show goodness and kindness to people who persecute me. Come on now. Yes. I'm willing to step out and believe God when it says, no, it's impossible. No, I'm going to believe God. Watch what God Amen. Will do. Amen. Watch what God Amen. Will do for us. You will find him in the very details of your life. You will find him writing you handwritten messages and leaving it for you to find. Amazing stuff. Saying, I'm just anxious to appear to you and reveal myself to you in the fullness of my glory. There's some things that you need to cooperate with me in so that it doesn't kill you or destroy you or ruin you. Huh? Huh? It's like, you know, there's every situation, every decision that we're making, everything that's going on in our life is saying something about a relationship with the Lord. It's telling him something. And when you discover that, you go, uh-oh. I'm talking and not even saying a word. I'm going to start recognizing what's coming out of my spirit, what's coming out of my behavior and my mannerism. I'm going to get myself before the Lord and I'm saying, God, I want you to take a hold of every part of my emotion. I want you to saturate every cell of my body. I want you to saturate every feeling. I want you to take me and I want you to wrap me up in your glory so I cannot move. I want to be like a baby and wrapped and swaddling. Because, wrapped, how you just like, they just cinch you down so you can't even cinch me down, oh God, with your glory. Come on. Yeah. You start talking to him like that. I'm going to tell you right now, Father will do it. He will do it. You want me to cinch you down in your glory? Are you sure? You want me to cinch you down in my glory? You want me to overwhelm you with my presence? You want me burning you with my fire of holiness? Are you sure? Are you sure? It's going to change everything. It's going to change everything. You're not going to be able to be the same person. You're not going to be happy with the same stuff no more. Oh God, burn in my spirit with your fire. Burn in my emotion, my passion. Are you sure? Yes, Father, do it now. Take hold of me. And the glory falls. Father's not in a hurry. Everybody else is in a hurry because they were raised in McDonald's. They were raised in fast food. They were raised in a world of quick advertisement and quick pleasure and quick gain and all these other things. And, you lose. They say that you got it. The commercial's got to, do it all in 13 seconds or you're going to lose their attention. God doesn't do things in 13 seconds. 13 years? 13 seconds? Huh? He's in an entirely different time scale. Amen. Hallelujah. Huh? He said, Lord, touch me. His hand's reaching out to touch you, and about 5 years later, bang. It was a second for him. It was 5 years for you. And it's not always that way. Sometimes it's instantaneously. It is a beautiful place to step into to know that, listen, there is a relationship to be had that when you call, he answers. It's a relationship to be had. If you don't believe it, you're never going to press into habit. You're going to do your little experiments offline, just casually, in your doubt and unbelief to just check and see. And I'm going to tell you right now, nothing's going to happen in your doubt and unbelief and you're casual. It's going to happen because you're earnest, you seek God, you're passionate, you're diligent, you do not weary in well-doing, you do not faint. You're going to go after it. You're going to reap this thing. Because you believe in God, who he is, and he's allowed to test you, and he's allowed to examine you, and he's allowed to try you, and he's allowed to ask you, how do you feel about the relationship now? In the midst of your crisis. Now, do you still believe that I'm God, and that I love you, and that I provide for you, according to all that you have need of, according to my riches and glory? And here you are, and it looks like that there's absolutely not two pennies to rub together. Eddie Boy was talking about where they were in a situation. And they had absolutely no money, zero money, zero money. He's preaching, zero money. He comes from a place of having no shoes. No shoes. No shoes. And listen, I'm telling you right now, he's got a PhD in mathematics, so it just shows you education won't hold you back. If you're right, if you're not all weird. He was humble enough to not make him weird. It's really what it comes down to. He's just poor. Great education, just poor. And they had no, and he was taking the kids out to tell them, to try to help explain to them the kind of soup that they were about to have, which is really no soup at all, which was just basically, a tree boiled kind of thing, a limb boiled. And he was out walking with them, and his dog darted into the bushes and come out with a squirrel. So he wrestled the squirrel out of his mouth. They went home, they had meat, praise God, right? And so and he was telling about this particular food. It's called okra meat. And all those people knew what that meant. I didn't know what that means, other than it's just boiled limb. And he was really, talking up the okra meat. He said, tonight we're having a special meat. It's called okra meat. And so the son was like, when are we going to have the okra meat? He said, sometime later. He said, that sometime later has never come. And of course, everybody there understood it, because what happened was at that time in his life, he made a transition into a realm of faith. He was in dire straits as he's being tried, as he's being evaluated, as he's being examined, as whether or not he was going to start, blaming God and accusing God, because that's what man does whose heart's wrong. Start blaming and accusing God. And then there's other people who they get into a place that they don't ask God nothing because they don't want to be disappointed. True. Are you one of those people? You don't ask God anything because you don't want to be disappointed when you don't get it. Huh? Or there's other people, they're just too humble to believe God would do the things that he's commanded to be done in their life. Huh? like signs and wonders and miracles and great exploits, and be able to see into the realms of heaven, be able to command and it happens, be able to speak and it comes to pass. You've got to do it and meet God, because I can't live without having these same kind of exploits, these same kinds of signs and wonders. And it's the Lord who's decreed it. Think about it. Well, I'm really happy with my life, and if the Lord gets around and he wants to give me the word of knowledge and the word of wisdom, I'm happy for that. No. I got to have it. I got to have it. See, all of a sudden you begin to covet spiritual gifts. And suddenly, when you begin to covet the spiritual, you recognize, wait a minute. I've been covetous of natural earthly things. You didn't even know it. Oh, I'm not covetous. I'm not material. I'm not materialistic. Yeah, you walk in your house and we can see very clearly you're not materialistic. Ha, ha, ha. You're not materialistic because you've got everything, man. You know what I'm saying? But you all of a sudden begin to be covetous for the spiritual. And then you see, wait a minute, there's been things vying for my covetousness. And I've been covetous about the wrong thing. And you can't serve God and mammon. You can't be covetous for the wrong thing and be covetous for the right thing. You can't have passions in pursuit for all of this stuff that can be supplied to you on a temporal basis and still have anything left over for God. In fact, he's not going to even be willing to have the mixture go on. Father's so good to us. Here he is working with us, and he doesn't give up working with us. It doesn't matter how old we get. Still, having begun in the Spirit, the Holy Ghost is there to perfect us. He wants to perfect us. He wants to bring us to maturity. God, having begun a good work in us, he wants to finish it. He's the author and finisher of our faith, but he's not going to do it unless we're willing to participate. His blood was shed for the sins of the whole world, but the sins of the whole world do not benefit because the sins of the whole world do not participate with it. They're not willing to believe what God said. And then we can take that and start ratcheting and back to right where you're living right now, that you're without all of these wonderful things that are supposed to be in your life, that are supposed to be being manifested in the church, because you're not passionate enough about it. You're not hungry enough for it. You're willing to live without it. You're allowing other things to spoil your appetite for God. You eating them spiritual Twinkies before you sit down and eat the meal. Spiritual Twinkie and a can of Coke of kill your appetite every time. Here you're going to have some good, nutritious food, delicious food, healthy for your body. But after the Twinkie and after the Coke, it tastes terrible. If you hadn't had the Twinkie and the Coke, it would have been delicious because you would have gotten the sugars that are there. Your taste buds would have delighted in the natural, healthy. Are you listening to me?
Yes.
It's what goes on. It's being spoiled. And Paul really emphasized where people were spoiled through philosophies and traditions. Spoiled. They're of no real value in the kingdom now. They have begun to believe other things. They bought into other things. And now they can't be hungry for the right things. They can't begin to receive the right things. Without hunger, you're never going to be able to receive what God's supplying. I'm going to tell you right now, if you just go ahead and shut down food, you'll begin to discover you can have a spiritual hunger that takes you beyond your hunger for food. Yeah. So all of a sudden, you begin to say, wait a minute, I'm getting this. I feel this thing. I feel there's something more here than what I thought before. Now I begin to have my desire on the unseen. So we look not on those things which are seen, or we don't have a desire for those things which are seen, but our desire is for the things which are unseen. Huh? Suddenly you lose your ambition. You fast long enough and you're not going to have ambition for anything. You're not going to have any ambition. No ambition. None. All you want is God. I just want God. I want heaven. I want to come to heaven now. Can I come to heaven now? Please. God, either use me in your glory and let your power and the demonstration of the Holy Ghost be made manifest to me like you have decreed in your word, or let me go ahead and come and be with you. And it becomes that passion. Hello. Are you listening to me? Whoa, that'll sort you out right there, won't it? That'll sort you out right there, won't it? Because you got all these ideas. You got all these plans. Well, how about my boat? I'll live for my boat. Or how about my this and how about my that and how about my the other thing? How about my other, you know, ambitions? Fasting take the ambition completely away from you. See, it's not by mind, it's not by power, but it's by my spirit. God has come and he's given to us a supernatural, miraculous new birth so that we are spirit, so that we can learn now to miraculously interact with him. And it's all a miracle. It's all a miracle. It's an entirely different conditioning. It is an entirely different training to give you an entirely different value system. And if you're not willing to come over and learn that and be taught that, if you're constantly getting fed from and satisfied from a worldly value system, you're never going to have this place of being taught of God. And tonight, I believe with all my heart that there's people in here that are just not going to be satisfied until you pray and the place is shaken. Yeah. There's people in here that are not going to be satisfied until you know, like Peter knew when Ananias and Sapphira came in. There's people in here, you're not going to be satisfied until the word of knowledge flows through you freely, until the word of wisdom is something that's constantly going on in your life, till miracles, as Jesus did miracles, as Paul did miracles, are happening through your life. And not just a few. And a few just doesn't satisfy you. A few just is a taste. Whet your appetite. You come and taste and say, these miracle things are good.
Yeah.
Gifts of healing just whipped your appetite and you're like, well, I've seen great miracles, but I haven't seen as many as I want to see.
That's right.
I've seen great demonstrations of the power of the Holy Ghost, but I haven't seen anywhere near the dimension that I'm longing for. I tasted. If you taste, you're like, I want that. You can have that or you can be an accountant. Or a secretary. Oh, forgive me. An executive. Huh? An executive assistant. An executive associate. I'm now an executive associate. I'm in all the top level meetings. For Dunkin' Donuts. Think about it. That in contrast to reigning with Christ Jesus, to signs and wonders and miracles, the display of divine power, his majesty radiating from your spirit, you being filled with every good thing that pertains to life and godliness, you function with divine authority, you say it and it happens, and you're going to trade that for being some executive associate and being in all the executive meetings for Dunkin' Donuts? Or whatever. Whatever, man. Whatever. I am. We are. The lollipop kids. Because that's really about it, man. That's really it. I don't care if it's Eli Lilly or the top, you know, Fortune 500 companies. Come on, it's the lollipop kids. It really is temporal. It's going to perish with the using. It only is just going to last a short while. What God's given us an opportunity to do is to enter into the realms of eternal life now, to function in the heavenly now, to lead the temporal, the temporality, and to go into the vastness of his eternity. Now. And it happens through prayer, passionate prayer. It happens through passionate prayer. It's like, oh, I think it should happen in a different way. It happens through passionate prayer. Elijah became really the one who decided what was going to happen in the world that he lived in because he knew how to pray. And through that prayer, he come under the mandate of what God decreed. And because God decreed it, Elijah was able to command it. And then all the natural elements obeyed. Joshua steps into a place with God and commands the sun, listen, I've got a battle going on here. Don't move. Moon, obey. One man with a special anointing commands the solar system by the Spirit of the Lord. People, this isn't fiction. This isn't something from long ago. You can't sit there and go, oh, I wish I lived in their day. No, 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 no. They're going, oh, to have lived in your day. They're right now, I'm telling you right now, they're looking over the balcony of heaven and going, these guys are losers. Let me in, Lord, let me in. There ain't nobody even moving. Look at them, the lollipop kids. Lord, let me in. Let me in. I can just see Paul. He's like, I can see it. He's looking over the balcony of heaven. We're in, look, the scripture says, we have a great company of witnesses, a great cloud of witnesses right now. Hebrews chapter 12. We're surrounded by a great cloud of witnesses. They're all looking, going, what are you doing now down there? Come on, people. Get into the pro. Who's going to lay hold on eternal life? Who's going to lay hold on this power and divine authority? Who's going to start moving in faith? Who's going to go beyond the natural and plunge into the realm of the supernatural? Who's going to quit living as a normal human being and rise up in the things of the Spirit and start functioning and moving with God? That's what's going on. I hear it. I feel it. I tell you right now, that is motivation to quit eating. I've had people come to me, I've had people who've done great things come to me whose lives got totally messed up, or even ministers. And they tell me about this issue and that problem, on and on, how they were crushed and devastated, and really it was their own fault anyways, their own wrong decisions, not making decisions in God. And so I just tell them, I can fix you right now. Eyes get real big. You can? Yeah. One preacher, he probably reached, I don't know, probably, well, if you hear him tell it was 12 million, it's definitely in excess of many millions. And did more crusades than anybody ever has ever done. And he came to me all messed up. I cast the devil out of him. Ann and I took care of him. Got totally liberated. And I said, now this is what you got to do. The patterns of your life are only going to change because you've got to, because of some certain things. Now, if you'll do what I'm telling you, you'll be fixed. He goes, okay, what? I said, start fasting. I lost his entire attention at that moment. I really want to get right, but I don't want to get right that bad. I really want to get these patterns of my life and these wrong thinking patterns that have been established in my life. I want to get them broken down. The wrong choices where I got conformed to the world instead of getting conformed to Christ. I want that stuff to be busted down. I want that to be dealt with. Because I'm telling you right now, people, when you start with the Lord Jesus Christ, you're a clean slate, you're a new creation, you're a brand new man. I'm telling you, you got the divine nature, you're good to go. It's just what happens between now and then. What happened? Your choices that you made, the sermons you got upset at, you didn't know how big of a spiritual violation that was. The anointing that you touched, you didn't know, because that resulted in you making more wrong decisions and touching more wrong things. It resulted in you touching the anointing in such a way that the Holy Ghost said, okay, well, you make your own decisions, see how that works out for you. I love you, but you know what? You got to repent. And then people go for long stretches, they don't repent, they don't even get it. They violated the things of the Spirit. They made one bad decision after another, after another, after another, after another. Now they're literally jaded with their bad decisions and their thought patterns and behavior patterns built up in their life that is literally alienating them from the life that they were born into in Christ Jesus. That stuff's got to be busted down. And it ain't just busted down because you got in a prayer line. It's busted down because you start fasting and praying and getting the thing right and getting readjusted. Praise God, repentance is there to reset. It's a reset button. But the patterns, the thought patterns and behavior patterns that we become attached to, that has got to be disrupted with some radical obedience. It does. It's got to be disrupted with radical obedience. Hallelujah. And I just, you know, I believe with all of my heart that God wants to train his people how to continually have new beginnings. Because Father's constantly telling us, come to the new. He wants you to forget about the old. You're sitting over there in the old. He said, forget about it. You can't even go with God. You're in the old. You're thinking about the old. You're thinking about ancient history. You're thinking about things that God don't even know about. He doesn't remember because he removed your sin as far as the east is from the west to remember that no more. I mean, you're over there in the old. He said, no, I'm doing new. I'm not going to hang out with the old. You guys, I'm going on in the new. He's way up there in light years, light speed. I'm new. And you're sitting over here, you know, in the old, all bummed out and burdened down with the old, something somebody did to you. It really didn't even happen. It's just an imagination of your mind. Wondering why God left you behind. I mean, give me a break. Hop on, man. Let's go. This is true. That's why finding New Year's in a time of New Year's, not make some kind of resolution you ain't ever going to keep. Because it's not by might and it's not by power. I mean, human discipline doesn't have that level to change the spirit. But consecration that he can keep. Because he will keep everything you commit to him. Yeah. Hallelujah. He'll keep it. And when he's keeping it, it's not by might, not by power, but it's by his spirit. It's his divine work. You say, Lord, I'm starting anew here. I want to start anew. Oh, God, I want you. I'm telling you right now, God, I want you. I'm not taking anything from 216 into 217. I'm not going to live on whatever happened then. I'm not going to live on the laurels. I'm not going to live on the accomplishments. I'm not going to be held back by the failures. I'm not going to be intimidated. I'm not going to be high on my boldness and my successes. I want you, God, like I've never wanted you before. Oh, God, I want to move forward with you into the eternities and into the vastness of all that you prepared for those who love you. Yeah. And it happens when it's there. It begins to be developed in your life where you're always, you've got a new start all the time. God gives us an opportunity to have a new start every second. He does. He does, because he gives us 490 times of repentance in a day. That breaks down to a couple of minutes, 2 minutes and some seconds, which reality of it is, says it's available every second. Every second. You can start new because the blood of Jesus Christ will cleanse you, will remove from you every offense, will never be held against you. It will never come up again. It will not be able to control you. It will not be able to hold you back. The problem is you retreat to your thoughts and your behaviors. That's the problem. The blood of Jesus fixes the issue. Now, what are you going to do? Are you going to be conformed to his image? In other words, are you going to learn to walk in his word? Are you going to learn to walk in his ways? Because that's where the trouble is in the first place, because you've already altered his ways. You've already modified his ways. You've already made excuses for why you don't have to, it's necessary for you to take thought for your food. Because if you don't take thought of it, who's going to take thought of it? And you don't get it. Because if you would say, okay, Father, I'm taking no more thought of your food, for my food, or for my clothes, which I'm going to put on, or for my concerns of my own earthly needs, then you would get it. Then you would step into a realm of supernatural, miraculous provision. You would begin to understand the faith realm of the kingdom, the supply of the Spirit. He would then begin to be able to provide for you according to his riches and glory. Out of that, you'd become very generous. You'd begin just give all the stuff you have. You just begin to give it, because now you have an unlimited supply. You have a bank account that can't run out. Amen. No, it's true. But as long as you're sitting there wondering, thinking about it, well, that doesn't make sense to me. Guess what? You're on hold, man. You're in the old things. You're just stuck in a human realm, and you can never go with the Holy Ghost. You're stuck in an earthly existence, and you're that which is born of the flesh is flesh, and you're stuck and captured in that place of temporality, that terrestrial confinement. And you need, and the only way that will change is if you're born of the Spirit, and now you can begin to move with the Holy Ghost. And that is radical. Hey, buckle up. This is more radical than any ride at Six Flags. Buckle up. This is going to take your breath away. Hang on. A man of God called me up one day. And he says, listen, I just had this radical dream. I said, I need some help with it. He said, there was an airplane. He said, it was taxiing down the runway. And I thought I was inside the airplane. Then I realized, no, I'm out here holding on to the wing. I said, get a good grip. Get a good grip, because Papa's taking you some supernatural places, man. Ain't no comfort zone for you, baby. Hang on, here we go. There's not a lot of people want that ride. They want the comfort. They want it easy. Nothing comfortable and easy about supernatural walking on water, walking over waves, commanding the armies of the aliens to be
disseminate. Nothing comfortable about taking nations. Nothing comfortable about moving in the exploits of God. Nothing. Always risking your life.
Amen.
Always. Amen. Always in jeopardy. But it is a high adventure. And Father takes good care of us all the way through it. It just depends on what are you going to do. Be one of just around me. I'll just praise the Lord. Praise the Lord. And that's all they ever do. And God loves them and they love God. I'm sure with their little praise the Lord. When they go home and holler at their husband, I can't believe you. And I'll just praise. And they live in that kind of a life. And God in His mercy and His grace is doing everything. It's terrible. He's doing everything in His grace to bring them along. But they don't want to go along. There's no passion. They get to experience the presence of the Lord, but they're never willing to let the presence of the Lord work within them a consecration and a surrender and a total abandonment. Abandonment. An abandonment. This is real relationship. It's real relationship. It's total abandonment to intimacy. Ooh. I do whatever you want me to do. I'll go wherever you want me to go. I'll be whatever you want me to be. So on such a radical level that I command it, so I cannot live without it. I must have these things in my life. Listen to me. Can you hear me?
Yes.
If you want to know why I fast and pray, now you understand. If you want to know why the men of old fast and prayed, now you understand. If you want to know why the men of the Bible and the women of the Bible fast and prayed, now you understand. If they needed to fast and pray, if Jesus needed to fast and pray, you and I really need to fast and pray.
Yeah. Amen. Yeah. Yeah.
If Paul needed to fast and pray, you and I need to fast and pray. To lay hold on the things of the Spirit, because I'm saying to the Holy Ghost, I really want to learn how to move with you. I'm so captivated by what I see, and I recognize that that's running interference with what you want me to see. So open my eyes so that I can be captivated with those things that you're looking at, so I can move with you. Oh, look at faith goes to a whole nother level. This is where supernatural faith goes to a whole nother level. Once again, I love the example of Elijah's servant, because he's saying, we're surrounded by the armies of the Syrians. My goodness, it's just two of you. It's just you and me. We're going to die here. There's so many of them. There's tens of thousands of them. And Elijah says, no, there's more with us than are with them. And he's like, what? What? And then he says, Lord, open up his eyes. He opens up his eyes. Suddenly, he's feeling sorry for the more of them. First, he was feeling sorry for his state. Now, he's feeling very sorry for their state. What happened? Faith went to a whole other level because he was able to see the realms of the Spirit, that which the spiritual realm was providing to come to his aid and to his assistance. Listen, that's the way it works. The Spirit of wisdom and revelation comes to us so that we can understand and appreciate the exceeding greatness of His power that has been given to us. Yeah. And until the Spirit of wisdom and revelation, which is the ability to see, which is the ability to discern, the ability to hear Him. Don't you want to hear Him? There are laws. We're going to do a School of the Spirit this Friday. There are ways to learn how to hear the Holy Spirit. And if you're passionate about hearing the Holy Spirit and you want that more than anything else, and then all these other things come to vie for your affection, and the demonic realm comes to try to shut down that passion with the lust of the flesh, the lust of the eye, and the pride of life. That's what sin is all about, to shut down passion for God, to shut down intimacy, to create alienation, distance between you and Him. It's the worst part of sin. The defiled conscience. That can't have confidence towards God and boldness towards God. If your heart doesn't condemn you, then you have confidence towards God. And whatever you ask, you'll have it. God wants you and I to come into a place of greater confidence on a level that whatever you ask, it's yours. Not 5 years from now. Then, immediately, call and I'll answer.
Amen.
That's why we fast and that's why we pray. That's why we give ourselves to the reading of the Word of God. That's why we give ourselves to spiritual things. That's why we begin to understand the spiritual weapons of our warfare, which are not carnal but mighty. Listen, people, you've got to understand exactly what they are and how they work. Because there's a lot of people going around talking about something they have no clue as to what it is. They talk about spiritual weapons and they cannot describe what those spiritual weapons are nor how they work. Thus, it's just simply irrelevant to them. There's no way you can participate with that. Hello. So let's come learn. Come learn. Paul says here, I'm going to see if I can get into this.
Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Frosande epitela butaha. Mandere kisti propata sifist. Say, I
do not
want
to fix myself.
I want to be fixed by God. And he's a good fixer. You see a problem with your life? You see something that's going on that is wrong, that needs to be corrected? Quit trying to be the person that's your own savior. Cry out to God, fix me, Lord. Father God, I want to love righteousness like you love it. I'm going to tell you right now, you start interacting with him, you'll love righteousness. Everybody in this place, you love righteousness and you hate iniquity. I'm telling you, you do.
Yeah.
And what really proves that you hate iniquity is the fact that the death and the destruction and the pain and the suffering and the guilt and the shame that comes with wrongdoing. You love righteousness because you love love and you love joy and you love peace and you love having things good and you love having things right and you love longevity of relationship and you love everybody getting along with each other. You love righteousness.
Yeah.
And the more you give yourself over to interacting with him, the more you love it and the more you hate iniquity. And there's where the anointing is increased. Because you loved righteousness and hated iniquity, I've given you an anointing greater than anybody else. See, there's where the anointing is increased. Right? And it's right there in an intimacy. God wants to give you special anointings, though. Something that you lay hold on. Something you lay hold on. Where all of a sudden you go, I've got to be. You know, you go after it. I have got to, you get passionate, I've got to be able to interpret tongues. I'm going to tell you, help you understand something. I got passionate about interpreting tongues, and it came to me strong. And then I'd find times where it's like I wasn't as passionate about it, and the gift would wane. And I'd stir myself up, and I'd get passionate about that interpretation of tongues. It was a gift, it was a special gift, it was already given to me, a special anointing, I had it. But I wasn't passionate about it. And when I wasn't passionate about it, it won't work. It won't work. It won't work. It won't work. I stir myself up with the gift that is given to me. I'm like, oh God, I gotta have that. Oh God, that is so beautiful. Oh Father, that is so wonderful. I gotta have that in my life. Boom, it'll just start flowing. I'm talking to you people. I'm not just trying to, you know, bring attention to myself and talk about me. I'm just using me as an example. I'm using my experience as an example that you can prove in the Word of God. And the examples that I've also heard from other men of God, examples that are true, they're valid things. And it will help you understand maybe why things aren't happening in your life the way they should be happening when it comes to spiritual gifts, because you're willing to live without it. I'm not willing. And then when I read some passages like this, then I really get to the place where I'm not willing. Huh? Listen to this. And I, brethren, when I came to you, came not in excellency of speech or of wisdom, declaring unto you the testimonies of God. I didn't come to you with excellency of speech. I didn't come and break this down. I didn't give you all my logic. You guys weren't sitting there, wow, he's an amazing teacher and expositor of the Word. Are you with me? Because that's where people are like, they're happy about that. There's a lot of you today. Well, wasn't that a great exposition? Oh, he's a great expositor of the Word. He's an amazing teacher. I'm an amazing teacher. Well, because you got all, that's what you want. That's where your heart is at. You don't get the rest. You all pumped up and filled up and satisfied so that you have nothing for passion left over. You hear me?
Yeah.
You have to watch it. Not only in the areas of things that are just, you know, natural things, carnal, worldly things, but also things that could look like it's right, it's good. It's a substitute. I'm going to be like Paul. I'm going to be like Paul. I'm going to be like Jesus. Jesus gave the sermons of Jesus. Man, he could have told us everything that happened before the beginning. I mean, he could have given us insight and revelation that would have just told us to break down everything as it is and as it exists. He could have told us stuff that Einstein didn't even know. I mean, you know, he kept us so simple because all he wanted to do was demonstrate the Holy Ghost and power. All he wanted to do is open up blind eyes. All he wanted to do is go to the heart of men and set the captive free. All he wanted to do was to release men from the prison. All he wanted to do was break down the power of everything that demon spirits had tried to build up in the lives of people. Here's what this you hear this? Yeah. I had a preacher say to me one time, he says, I'm in his living room. He says, I could never be you. I said, why would you want to be, man? He said, I could never have all the training you have and all the Bible knowledge that you have. I'm like, why would you want to be? You know what God gave him? God gave him a demonstration of the Holy Ghost in signs and wonders. And he had some little podunk little sermon to give. It was so simple, it was basically be the height of maybe a 10-year-old sermon. But there was signs and wonders and the demonstration of the power of God. Why would he ever want anything else?
Right.
Why would you ever want anything else? I want both. Yeah. Yeah. I want both. I want both. I'm going for both. I want that one, 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 that one. It's like one guy said, it's like when it comes to the things of the Spirit, I'm like a guy in the buffet. I lick my fingers and say, that's my. I claim it so nobody else touches it. Beautiful. I love it. Come on, it's covetousness. Covetousness means you got covetousness and you raking it in all for you. That's covetousness. When are you going to start being covetous and quit being having a false humility and start getting covetous? I got to have that. Give me some more of that. Come over here. For I determined not to know anything among you, save Jesus and him crucified. It's absolutely cornerstone. Got to grab a hold of this. The whole consciousness there is every one of my sins have been put away and all of my alienation from God no longer exists. It's all been destroyed. I have been redeemed. I'm one with him. All that the cross, all that the redemption in the cross supplied, because he's not leaving out the resurrection because he was a resurrection preacher, and he's not leaving out the baptism of the Holy Ghost because he's a baptism of the Holy Ghost preacher. He's just seeing it all right there and now having no conscience with anything. Thought of sin, a conscience void of offense, an absolute certainty of his oneness and his union with God. There's no intimidation there. There is no fear there. It's just this absolute certainty of who he is in God because of what Jesus did. Hear that? It's such a principle. There's more to say there, but it's good. I want to grab all of this real quick. He says this. He says, and I was with you in weakness. Listen to this. Weakness and fear and in much trembling. Look at the posture. He is under an absolute awareness and awe that God is watching his every move and that he's speaking on God's behalf, and he is absolutely overwhelmed with the magnitude of that responsibility. I don't want to get it wrong. Not one word's coming out of my mouth unless I know it's God Almighty. See the disposition of humility and brokenness that is there. That is how the anointing functions. Jesus tried to show it to us. He said, listen, come and learn of me. I'm meek and lowly. Let me show you how the anointing works. Sit down. I'm going to wash your feet. I'm going to be servant of all. I'm going to show you how to function in this place of brokenness. That's what he's describing in fear and much trembling. There was no zero self-confidence. Zero self-confidence. Zero. An academician trained in many languages, trained in all biblical literature. Zero self-confidence. Zero understanding in himself. In much fear and much trembling. Think about it. In weakness and fear and much trembling. Think about it. Zero self-confidence. He says, we are not sufficient of these things, for our sufficiency is of God. Listen to where he's at. Look where his disposition is. Where did that come from? His intimacy. His revelation, his interaction with the dynamics of the presence and the power and the glory of God that surrounded him, that made him an oracle and a mouthpiece. Come on now. I want to touch that more. I want that more. And so he says, here is the result of that. See, here's the conditions. The conditions are set up. The conditions are this. One, I'm not going to rely on wisdom. I don't want to be an orator.
I don't want to impress people, number one. Number two, this whole thing is all about Jesus Christ and Him crucified and the redemption that has been supplied and my oneness and my righteousness that is of God and not of myself. Because that's what He's saying. He's saying all those things. I don't have my own righteousness. I've got the righteousness of God. I don't have my own holiness. I've got the holiness of God. I've got this gift of salvation that came to us by the way of this miraculous provision where God was made flesh. He's telling us the disposition of His life. What He doesn't want to be, an orator, a teacher. Where His position of confidence is in the cross of Christ Jesus. Now He's showing us His disposition of brokenness and humility. I have zero self-confidence. I'm wanting every utterance to be God-inspired and God-moved. And I'm captivated in this place of awe, overwhelmed with the magnitude of His presence that I feel in right now. You hear me?
Yes.
And look at the result now. And this is His lifestyle. And we see this in His lifestyle because there's other places we could go and see the same kind of mannerism in Paul. And people would actually make fun of him. And said, look, he's weighty in words, but in presence, my goodness, look at him. He's kind of like a little timid guy. In word, he's powerful. But here in presence, he's like, he's not what I was expecting. He's like this short little soft-spoken guy. He doesn't seem to have a lot of confidence. But out of it comes a display of the power of God. Suddenly they change their mind. Suddenly when the blind eyes start opening, suddenly when the power of God starts moving, suddenly when the demonstration of the Holy Ghost and power begins to be manifested on a scale like no one's ever seen, they change their opinion about Him. He says this, and my speech and my preaching was not in persuasive words. It was not enticing, wasn't persuasive. I wasn't going out trying to really touch your logic and your understanding, get you to agree with me and, you know, win the debate. My speech, my preaching was not with enticing words of men's wisdom. My speech and my preaching, here's in my speech and my preaching. My speech and my preaching was a demonstration of the Holy Ghost and power. Now I want you to zero in on exactly what does that look like. So you say, he preached. Did you do doctrine, Paul? I mean, if you're just preaching demonstration of the Holy Ghost and power, one of the first things you might think about is, I remember when he was preaching, telling people about Jesus in Acts, I believe it's Acts 14:6, and suddenly beheld a man earnestly looking at him, and he beheld that he had faith to be healed. And he said, stand upright on your feet. Right there in the middle of the sermon, stand upright on your feet. And the man was made completely whole. I see how he's moving in demonstration of the Holy Ghost and power. Huh? We know that he's always going to be talking about the Holy Ghost because that's one of the things that he does, seeing people be baptized in the Holy Ghost and fire. We understand that that's part of his ministry. We understand that praying for the sick is part of his ministry because you see the people at the house of Tyrannus, how they come and they grab aprons and handkerchiefs from his body because everybody's getting healed. They're watching people get healed. And so they're taking anything that he's attached to him home with them because if they can get healed there, they can, you know, with him touching them in that meeting, they're going to take something that he's touched home with them, lay it on the people that are sick, and the people that are sick are going to get healed there too. The faith of the people. He didn't instruct for that to be done. There's no evidence that he instructed for that to be done. It was the faith of the people. Think about it. The demonstration of the Holy Ghost in power. So you can get a little bit more insight on that when you go in 1 Corinthians chapter 14 and you hear what Paul says. He says in verse 6, give you time to get there. He says, now, brethren, if I come unto you speaking with tongues, hallelujah. He says, what shall it profit you except that I speak to you by revelation, by knowledge, by prophecy, and by doctrine? So here he's telling us, he's giving to us a description of how he ministers. First and foremost, he's desiring the spiritual, and he's trying to bring them into a place of desiring the spiritual. He says, look, we're born of the Spirit, desire the spiritual. There's no reason for you to function out of a human earthly realm when God has given you a divine realm to function in. You want to function in a divine realm? You can walk in divine power. You can have divine health. You can move in divine healing with a divine nature. You can have a divine interaction. You can have continual divine encounters. You can have divine revelation so you can display the divine.
the person of the Lord Jesus Christ. Think about it, people. This is the demonstration of the Holy Ghost in power. As he begins to speak by revelation, as he begins to speak by wisdom, as he begins to speak by knowledge, as he also speaks by doctrine, so it's not his doctrine, it's not him taking a bunch of words, lining them up together, getting finding out what his what his denomination believes, and then going ahead and giving a speech. It's rather the Spirit of the Lord connecting all of the revelation from Genesis all the way through to where he stood at that moment in time and beyond. And now he expressing this light that has been given to us in God and this mystery in Christ Jesus. If there's anything that would captivate us in understanding, distilling it all down of what does it actually look like in the midst of the church that Paul's ministering in, it would be 1 Corinthians chapter 12 and verse 7. And he's saying this is, and he just fits into this. He's just fitting into this. He says, the manifestation of the Spirit is given to every one of us, every one of you, to profit with it. So he's saying, I've come to you in the demonstration of the manifestation of the Spirit and power. What does that look like? What fundamentally, what does it look like in the ministry of Jesus? It looks like this. As the Holy Ghost is speaking and moving through the life of the Lord Jesus Christ, somebody cries out because they're demon possessed, and immediately the devil goes out of them. Somebody is a place that they're sick and they're crippled and they're bent over, and the power of God is there to touch them and heal them. And Jesus grabs a hold of them, straightens them out. It's this gathering of people unto him to hear the words that only God can deliver, and everybody that's there in the place, no matter what their problem is, whether they're blind or sick, or diseased, or deaf, or crippled, there's the power of the Holy Ghost, the demonstration of the Holy Ghost, the signs and the wonders and the miracles of Jesus Christ. They're delivering everybody from whatever problem they have. That's us. That's what we're supposed to be doing. If we have any other expectation, then our expectation is completely wrong. And if that isn't something that's flowing in your life, then it's something that you need to covet and lay hold on. Because the premise here is that to covet the spiritual gifts, to have it, to lay hold on it. That this is how we're supposed to be ministering. And to minister any other way is debunked by Paul right here. It's debunked. So he says, let's go look at it together. Because I want you to get hungry. I want you to go to my Facebook page. Everybody's fasting, right? Everybody's fasting and praying. Some form of fasting and praying, right? Yes. Yes. Some. Yes. Amen. Thank you. Yes. Come on, let's go to war. Yes. Amen. Come on, let's go back to these things. Let's demand of ourselves what God has commanded. Yes. Let's demand of ourselves what God has commanded. Yes. Stop it. Demand of yourself what God has commanded. Yes. Stop doing what you've been doing. Amen. God approves us of our intimacy and of our walk with him by signs and wonders and demonstration of the Holy Ghost and power. Why would we be willing to not have the signs of his approval in our life? Hello. All of these things he said is ours. Why would we be willing to allow Satan, the thief, and all the things of doubt and unbelief to come and steal and kill and destroy what God has given to us? Why would we be have anything less than special anointings and the demonstration of the power and the authority that has been given to us as sons of God? And then more, those who have been baptized in the Holy Ghost and fire to do his works and greater works. If you're not hungry, quit eating. Do you hear me? I said, if you're not hungry, quit eating. Somebody said, did you say it right? I said, if you're not hungry, quit eating. Huh? If you're not hungry for spiritual things, quit eating natural food. Because I'm going to tell you right now, your hunger for food will turn into spiritual hunger. If it's done in faith, if you're crying out to God the Father in the name of Jesus Christ, that name gives us access. I don't care who you are. I don't care what you've done. That name has all power and it has all authority, and all heaven stands at attention. I don't care who says that name. All heaven's looking around. Who said that name? Right over here. Jesus, Jesus, Jesus. I'm going to say it enough so everybody knows. Right over here. I promise you, hell knows my name. I promise you, I've cast out enough devils and dealt with enough devils that they know who I am. And you need to get yourself on the list. Yes. Come on, man. Yes. Come on now. Yes. You need to grab a hold of this place and ministry in Christ Jesus. So many people have stepped into a special anointing, a special work of divine grace. Suddenly they get some popularity and they get some money. They get a new dress, new outfit, whatever, new hairdo, new car, new wristwatch, new ring. And all of a sudden, the shiny beauty, sharpness of the a little bit of anointing that they had received that was just a barely little bit above everybody else begins to dull. And they lost their passion. It's wonderful when people stay broken before Him and say, no, I want more. I haven't even gotten close to what I want. And it's wonderful when people, when God identifies and says, no, you know what? If I gave you a big church, you'd quit seeking me, so I'm going to keep you in a small one. It's fine. If I allowed you to have too much success, you wouldn't be given the passion and the desperation that I need to change this region. I'll keep you small, so I'll keep you passionate. I want to be able to come to a place in God where you can say, okay, I know that if I enlarge you and give you more success, you're going to remain with the same kind of passion and pursuit. I've watched too many people. Father has brought me supernaturally. I've become close friends, even best friends, with some of the greatest, men and women of God that have been raised up and just had that thing going on in my life, that special favor going on in my life for a number of years, just to watch how so many times things just shut down the passionate pursuit. That they were on it, man. They were on it. They were on it. Just pursue. Be passionate. Don't get all bummed out because of what people are doing. Don't lose track because things aren't happening the way you think they're happening. Pursue. Be passionate. Go after the riches of heaven. Go after that which you discovered in that passion, in that brokenness, and in that humility, in that longing, in that desperation. Keep the desperation. It's one of the things that I love about Addie Boy. I see the desperation in him. I see the childlike passion and pursuit of someone who has nothing, who's barefooted and don't have any food to go into the pot, still in the man who have great success. That's what I want to be. That's what I want to do. I'm like, let me hear more. And fortunately, there are so many YouTubes. Let me hear more. Let me hear more. I want to hear more. Somebody who was able to step in to the riches and the rewards and the success of the anointing and still remains as desperate as they were when they had no shoes and no meat and no money and no success and no fame. Come on. Lord, work that out in me. Whatever you got to do, work that out in me. And I'm going to tell you right now, I'm not going to be sitting around satisfied while Father's taking his time. I'm going to be pursuing this. Let's get this done. Let's get this done. Let's get this thing done. Let's do this. Let's do this. Let's do this. Let's do this, Lord. And I'm praying right now for myself, and I'm praying on your behalf right now. My conversation is in heaven. These things are really, this is all about what we're doing for the next 21 days. That's what this is all about. Are you going to be satisfied with your life in this world? Or are you going to hate your life in this world?
Yes.
You never hate your life in this world till you see your life in heaven. Then you go, what? I don't that. I'm over here. I don't that. You got to be kidding me. It's an embarrassment. It'd be like you stepping over into your heavenly body, glorified body. And then, somebody asking you, would you like to go back into your earthly rag? Are you listening to me? You'd be going, what? That? That stinky, corruptible thing? All of its aches and pains? Are you with me? I know we didn't feel that way about ourselves when we were 16 years old. What did you get to be 58? Jesus. I want you to lay, God says he wants you to lay hold on him. It's kind of like tackling him. That's like grabbing him and won't let go. God says he wants you to lay hold on him. He's looking for some people to lay hold on him. He's looking for some people to leave every other earthly interest behind and have all their affections in the heavenly realm. He's just looking for some people that'll be like that. Have that kind of passion, have that kind of desire, have that kind of pursuit for him. Because he wants to pour out all of his splendor and all of his majesty through the lives of those people who are willing to go all the way with him, who are willing to receive from him what he freely gives because they're willing to walk with him. They're willing to agree with him. Instead of walking with the world and coming and visiting him every once in a while, he wants some people to come live with him, be a part of the family, live in the house, yes. Not constantly moving in and out. Paul really, in many respects, he summarizes the manifestation of the Spirit, the demonstration of the Spirit. He summarizes it, as it were, into categories, but has many different outworkings, but he summarizes it. And he says it's ours. He says it's already ours. It's already been given to us. The church was purchased with Jesus' blood. It was baptized in the Holy Ghost and fire. It's the fullness of him that filleth all things. It's a personality and personal, as it were, manifestation of Jesus in the earth. He's placed within the midst of the church all of these supernatural workings, the heavenly realm. It's all that he possesses in the throne room of his glory. He's placed within the church. There's special anointings. Father wants you to grab a hold of them. He wants you to lay hold of them. You can lay hold of them.
Amen.
What's more important to you, a hot dog or a supernatural authority in God? Huh? What's important to you, some pancakes with some bacon? Huh? Huh? Or laying hold on special anointings? Because when you begin to seek it, these things, by faith, you begin to seek them by laying hold on the things of the Spirit of God, the way God ordained it and fashioned it, you will have them. They will be yours when passion arises. Here, let me give you a kiss, baby.
Yes, Jesus. Thank
you. You feel better now?
Yes.
She's doing good. I cough like that sometimes. You know what Mimi says to me? She says, quit acting like Hannah. I said, I can't help it. We're just the same. There's some overtones in that, but only a few people understand. Verse 7. You say, oh, Paul, where did he get the demonstration of the Holy Ghost and power? Baptized in the Holy Ghost and fire. He got it exactly the same place that you and I received it from. The ministry of Jesus. You should be baptized with the Holy Ghost not many days from now. You shall receive power. After that, the Holy Ghost has come upon you. That's where he got it from. He just says, I'm going to stay over in this realm. Instead of me being the leader and me being in charge, I'm going to stay over in this realm of being moved by the Holy Ghost, listening to him. I'm going to stay in this place of weakness and trembling and fear before God to say, Lord, I don't want to do anything of myself. You got me. Take me where you want me to go. I'm going to stay under this divine empowerment, this divine inspiration, this divine wind of God, and I'm going to move with him. In other words, every person that has ever been used by God, they pretty much said the same thing. I'm talking about on levels of national and international exploits. They said, when asked, how is it that they move in such exploits? They said, one simple answer, I stay yielded. Staying yielded is a full-time disposition of your intimacy and your relationship with him, of moving with the Holy Ghost. It's where you say, Michael, you say, I want to learn how to move with the Holy Ghost. I want to learn how to walk with him. I want to learn how to live in him. I want to learn how to hear him talk. I want to see what he sees. I want to know what he knows, because he's taken everything that belongs to God and he's here to teach me. He's here to give it to me. And I want to learn. And so I'm going to lay everything else aside that I might be taught of God. If you want to be taught of men, you're not going to be taught of God. If you're going to rely on yourself, you can't have him. If it's going to be might and by your power, you can't have His Spirit. It's one or the other, folks. About the 21st day, you start facing some stuff. That's about the time it starts kicking in. You go, I ought to go on. Because all of a sudden, things that have played tricks on your mind and your thinking, where you've rationalized wrong thinking, where you've taken on wrong behavior, it becomes exposed. It sticks out like you walking around in your underwear. In the street. Eh? It sticks out to you like you walking around in the shopping center in your underwear. Would you like to see? Would you like to see? Would you like your eyes to be open? Would you like to know how to make some adjustments?
Yes.
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
I want to speak accurately, boldly, and powerfully on His behalf in the year 2017. Yeah. And all I'm doing is getting ready. I'm serious about this. I'm not just whimsically saying it would be nice if I could speak on His behalf accurately and boldly with great authority in 2017. I'm after it, man. Come on.
Yes.
You're not allowed to fast because you're pregnant. But some people, I look at them, I know. I just know. I can see it in her eyes. I can see it in Ellie's eyes. She's like laying hold on it. She's passionate about it. She's ready. And you're nursing. And this is the way it is. But the husbands could grab a hold of it.
Amen.
Hallelujah. And mom and everybody can participate in the prayer where you take prayer up to another level, where you shut out the world around you.
Yeah.
Shut it out.
Yes.
Shut it out. Take a little bit of time and see how nice it is to come out from among them and touch not the unclean thing.
Yeah.
Take a vacation from the world. Yeah. You'll like it so much, you'll decide to move in. Hallelujah. Praise God. You'll say, woo, we just stepped into something so better, so much better. Hallelujah. And then the cry for these things will become such a plea in your life. I promise you, at first it may be hard for you to find enough prayer to pray, enough energy to pray those prayers, enough inspiration and motivation to feel today, but it can't be before long. You won't be able to shut it down.
Amen.
You can't shut it down. It's a Holy Ghost flow that causes you to feel heaven, to feel eternity, to feel the presence of God Almighty, to recognize angels are still ascending and descending upon the Son of Man, Christ Jesus, and He's in you. Wow. He is the center of the universe and He is in you. He is God Almighty and He's in you. He's seated upon the throne of authority above all principality and power and might, and He's in you. Whoa. And now all of a sudden you're like, oh God, arise. You begin to look at the need and you're confident and you're bold. You're bold and confident, full of faith that need is going to be supplied by Christ Jesus, whether it's blind, sick, diseased. I want to live in that all the time. I don't just want to have sporadic moments of it. I can look in the history of my life and I can see sporadic moments of great faith. I want to live in it full time. I'm going to live in it.
Amen.
I'm going to.
Amen.
I'm going to lay hold of that which has laid hold of me. Huh? I'm going to lay hold of that which has arrested me. So are you.
Yes.
Yeah, you are. God's calling you and you're going to come.
Yes.
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Thank you, Lord Jesus. He says, the manifestation of the Spirit is given to every man. This is what you receive when you're baptized with the Holy Ghost and fire. This is what you receive when you receive power from on high. He says, to one is given by the Holy Ghost the word of wisdom, to another the word of knowledge by the same Holy Ghost, to another faith by the same Holy Ghost, to another gifts of healing by the same Holy Ghost, to another the working of miracles by the same Holy Ghost, to another prophecy, to another discerning of spirits, to another many different kinds of tongues, and to another interpretation of tongues. But all of these work that one and the self-same Holy Ghost divide into every man severally as He wills. But all of these work that one and the selfsame Spirit divided to every one, every man severally as he will. Individually. Dividing individually to each person according as he wills. And I want what he wills.
Yes.
I'm not going to live what I will. I'm going to say, my Father in heaven, your will be done.
Amen.
Stop living by my will. He's willed this.
Yeah.
He's willed special anointings.
Yeah.
You lay hold on him.
Amen.
Over the next 21 days, lay hold on him.
Yeah.
Lay hold on them.
Yes,
get covetousness.
Yes,
covetous. Get passionate. Get purposeful. Get just desperate. And watch what happens. You absolutely will love the great rewards that are found in seeking God. Hallelujah. Everybody stand with me. Thank you, Jesus. You know, my heart is set on the church. One of the things that I'm laying hold of in God is here in the church, that the growth and the maturation and the purposes of God will be fulfilled in this ministry. Another dimension of what I'm so, there's a lot to that, what I just said. There's a lot of details there. I'm also just determined and passionate about anybody in this place that has any kind of sickness or disease, it not existing. It has no right to even exist. It is a reproach. It's a reproach. It's a lying reproach of hell. I'm not saying that the individual is a reproach. It's the enemy's lie that's a reproach. We're going to get after the thing. Get it down on the ground and beat it in the head until it can't move. Come on, man. I'm telling you right there. Huh? Hallelujah. Praise God. You let God, the Holy Ghost, begin to stir you and show you those things that He desires to have happen in your life in the midst of the church. And then you begin to be a part of praying that thing through into reality. Hallelujah. I want you to just lift your hands towards heaven right now. If you do not have fiery prayer in your life, then I want you to do this. I want you to lay hold on it. Over the next 21 days, each person, no one's holding you back. You're deciding. God will produce fiery, passionate prayer in your life. And out of that, you're going to begin to see a development of a great passion, even more so, for the gifts of the Spirit, for the demonstration of the Holy Ghost and power. I want you to pray with me and cry out to God and say, Lord, let the abiding place be so lit up with your presence that it doesn't matter what kind or what type of people come in here, whether they're religious, God-denying, don't care, totally wicked, they're overwhelmed by your presence. I want you to give yourself to having such love for everybody in this place that love is welcome to reside. Because all that's going on is love, and you're not allowing anything else inside. Just look at what God has chosen. Look at what He desires. Look at what He demands. And just simply give yourself over to doing it and having it. To doing it.
Amen.
You don't have to have a special work of grace to participate with love. You've just got to be willing to quit going your own way and start going His way. And I'm going to tell you, just like you respond to love because you're not willing to do it your way, you're willing to do it His way, and you've learned to come to His place of His inspiration by obedience, Same way with joy, same way with miracles, signs and wonders, same way with tongues, interpretation of tongues, same way with prophecy, doesn't work any difference. Works the same way. Works the same way. There's things, it's just not as obvious. You know, when you're not willing to participate with love, the feelings, the attitudes, maybe the issues are more overt, they're more obvious. It's not as obvious when it comes to working a miracle. You don't know the fear that holds you back. You don't know the intimidation. You don't know the second guessing that holds you back. But what God will do is He will show you how to deal with that the same way that you deal with any kind of bad feelings, any kind of offense, any kind of unforgiveness, any form of hate, anything that would keep you from the expression of His love. You learn how to shut that stuff down and say, no, I'm not going to go with it. I don't care what bad things are said. I don't care what people feel about me. I don't care what I think they might think about me. I'm going to just participate with God's love. I'm going to love them like they love me, and I'm the most favorite person in the world. You learn how to do that, to cooperate with God and obey God. Same way with miracles. Same way with gifts of healing. God, some Father sometimes, He just moves and He gives a special gift of faith where that can't even work. I mean, I've been in that situation with a special gift of faith. I mean, I've walked out on a platform with multitudes and multitudes of people, tens of thousands of people, with such boldness and confidence, and it wasn't in myself, it was a special gift of faith to watch God do extraordinary things. And He does that. But there's things that God wants to develop us in where we just step out in miracles, and He says, now you throw down and you cast down every intimidation, every fear, everything that would try to keep, every second guessing, everything that would be of yourself, every place where you look to your own strength. I remember I was intimidated for a while in my life because it seemed like if I barely prayed for somebody, they got healed. But if I really went after it, nothing happened. I'm like, when I'm really going after it, so I'm like second guessing God. When I'm really going after it, I'm putting too much self in there. I'm relying too much on what I can do. And when I just barely touch them, it's all about what God could do. And then I was with the man of God and said, listen, I would go down the line with him praying for hundreds and even thousands of people, and he would just touch people, touch them, touch. He said, just leave it there. Just don't go anywhere. Don't go any place with it. Let God do it. And so it just kind of like that much more kind of solidified that. But the Lord was saying, no. That's not the whole picture. That's not the whole picture. Let me show you more. But guess what? You're going to have to go into the same secret chamber of instruction that He's invited me to come into so you can understand it, because you're never going to grab a hold of it if I tell you, if I break it down for you. You just got to, I just give you a little bit of tools to work with just so that you understand some of the basic adjustments that got to be made. Things that only God, the Holy Spirit, can show you. And you've got to break past you. And it's crazy how much gets in the way. You wouldn't think so. After all, the Lord, you know, it's natural. Gets in the way. You don't have to, though. You don't have to. And I promise you, if you're willing to step in this realm, and this is, hear me, and I'm closing with this. It's very important, though. When you begin to step into the realm of divine revelation, encounters with God, and then you go back to the same way that you were before, I don't know that there's any greater violation. I watched in the 90s so many people touch with the power of God, and all they did was go back to their former lifestyle. It didn't bring change. It didn't bring a passionate pursuit. Here they have an encounter with God, and it should have brought a passionate pursuit. Now, there were some who did. There were many who did. But to go into this place where you begin to get a divine revelation, you begin to have this divine interaction, you begin to touch this place of the power of the world to come. And then to be willing to say, hey, that was nice, that was cool, that was really cool. Okay, what's the next, you know, great adventure in the world? What did I miss out on? Ooh, I don't want to do that. Father knows, He searches our hearts, He tries our hearts, He sees where we're at. He knows tonight the people in here that are desperate for Him, that are hungry for Him. And He knows the people that are not. And He says, I'm going to tell you right now, He says, God says that lukewarmness is the greatest violation to Him that He knows of. He says it is the most obnoxious thing that he knows of. He said it makes him sick to his stomach. That's what he says. He says if you lukewarm about these things, I paid such a price to give you this most sacred thing that there exists, to give you this place of holding nothing back that I have, freely giving it to you. And if you're just going to snub your nose at it, and you're going to remain lukewarm about it, he said, I'll spew you out of my mouth. And that is a Middle Eastern expression of I want nothing to do with you. As a Middle Eastern expression, I want nothing to do with you. He's calling for the pastor. And I want that lukewarmness cured, says the Lord. He doesn't point it out to say you're done. He points it out to say, I counsel you to buy of me gold tried in the fire, that you may have white raiment, that your nakedness will not appear. This is God. You say, I'm not lukewarm, I'm just not passionate. I say, you're deceived. Why do I say that? Because God said, I want you to be hot, or I want you to be cold, but don't be lukewarm. I'd rather that you be hot. God only defines hot. Hot is only defined in the Bible as the fire of God. And fundamentally, that is expressed in our passions. It's a passion. Fire in your passion. Your passion. You can hear it in the sound of your voice. You can hear it in the sound of your praise. It is expressed in your obedience to God. Of how willing you're willing to protect, of how much you're willing to participate. You show me people who honor the anointing, and I'll show you folks who can receive from heaven. Because they honor God. They honor Him. Tonight, Father wants to fix you. A few minutes ago, you said, I don't want to fix myself. God, I want you to fix me. God wants to fix you. He is here to fix us. Mercy's new every morning. Willing to wash us and cleanse us 490 times in a day. Need it. God wants you to repent and be done with sin. God wants you to repent and be done with sin. God wants you to repent and be done with sin, because through that repentance, you get to step in to the joy of life with Him. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Who said that? Hallelujah. No, I just heard the sound of heaven. So I just want to know who said it. I'm on Shekinah. I love to hear something that goes beyond the voice of man. And God will cause you to be able to hear too. Somebody said, how can you hear that? How can you see that? Listen, I tell you, there's a whole lot more that I want to hear and a whole lot more than I want to see. I hear it and I see it because He's opened up my ears that I may hear. Because I desire it more than anything else. Because He's opened up my eyes because I want to see. I desire it more than anything else. But there's a whole lot more I want to hear. I want to know on another level of revelation that every time I speak, Father hears me. Hear Jesus. Father, I know that when I speak, when I pray, you always hear me. But I'm saying it now so that those that are standing around can be in on the conversation. That's what Father wants us to have. Do you want that? Oh, Ramam, Kutabara, Moshikia. Amen. Morimando braba kasiti de de la mosabra baba kutala la baba vekita la la mahasa. Tonight, Father's forming in the hearts of his people hunger, passion. He's forming within our lives the ability to lay hold on supernatural things. It's happening right here in Z's life. It's happening right here. Divine appetites are being created in him right in this place tonight. There's destinies being initiated, being formed, being shaped in God right here tonight. Eternal destinies. Things that we're deciding that we're going to participate with 10 billion years from now. I'm deciding tonight not only things that I'm going to participate with over the next 21 days, the things that I, in that decision, I'm making this, because of that decision, in that decision, I'm deciding things that I'm going to be doing in God's plan 10 billion years from now, because I'm willing to decide with his interest right at this moment. I'm willing to agree with him right now. And yes, that's that step towards.
Thank you, buddy God. Yes, Lord. Hallelujah.
All the rest of his plans for me being fulfilled.
Yes. Yes, Lord.
You too.
Yes.
I'm not missing heaven. If I thought I needed to stay right there at that platform right there till Jesus comes so I can make heaven, I wouldn't move. You had to bring me my food there. The number of people that God has brought into this ministry, that God planned to produce within their life, these kinds of destinies. Do you know how many people that are in this town that have come through this ministry? People. It's huge. It's a huge number. Huge. And here we are tonight. Father's looking for a group of folks that will so with total abandonment lay a hold on him so he can utilize them to take the whole of the nation. Take the whole of the nation. Take the whole of the nation. Right now on the web, Kay just sent me the statistics. Over the past year, every state in the United States of America has watched us. People from every state in the United States of America has watched us on the web. I don't remember how, I didn't look at how many countries. But, you know, many, many countries. Last year it was well over 100. Some of them know the back of your heads very well. People asking me, would I please get another camera so that they could see you? I'm waiting for that moment. I want it to be an extraordinary blessing to see you. I don't want to email me and say, go back to one camera, go back to one camera. Because when they look at the back of the head, your head, they don't know if you're shining or not. They don't know if you're smiling or frowning or what. And I believe that every one of them thinks that you're smiling and that it's glorious, that it's radiant. Amen. Father's just, people, Father, and I say that for making a point. Father's looking for real simple cooperation that is within our grasp right now. Right now. He said, no. There's things that you can do right now that you're not willing to do it. And you want me to do these other things? No. You got to do what I've asked you to do. This right now within the power of your obedience right now. And until you're doing it, I'm not moving forward with you. This is Father. And tonight he wants every person in this place humble themselves under the mighty hand. Humble yourself under the mighty hand. What you being all grumpy about now? Oh,
You hungry? Look at that sad smile. You hungry? You hungry, huh? Oh, I know how that is. No, I'm not really hungry. I got meat to eat, the spiritual food. I know food can make you feel like this.
True.
I know food can make you feel like this. No coffee, no mate, no chocolates, no desserts, huh? No super delicious and cooking. Lay hold on God. Take hold of Him. Everything that He has is yours. And you'll be able to receive it because you find all of your issues settled in the cross of Jesus Christ. Determined to know nothing but Jesus and Him crucified. All of your issues, all your problems, all the reason why God might not like you has been completely settled. Has been completely remedied. So that doubt and unbelief can't harass you and hold you back.
Thank you, Lord.
So that you find yourself well prepared, well able, worthy, hallelujah, holy,
yes.
Acceptable,
yes.
Chosen,
yes.
Called, elected,
amen.
Purposed. All there is to do now is just receive.
Yes.
Thank you, Jesus. You lay hold on special gifts, for special gifts are here for you. You lay hold on special gifts, for special gifts are here for you. Maturita mupare de ribisti. Mambrobobo sukori di andara da bakada. Mandole ete bo osate extra. Mangolo koti akara rabo shabara de iki. Hallelujah. 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 You are the mighty God. Hallelujah! You are the mighty God, the great I am. Hallelujah! Hallelujah! You are the mighty God. The great I am, hallelujah, hallelujah. You are the Alpha and Omega, the beginning and the end, who was and is to come. You are the Alpha and Omega, the beginning and the end, who was and is to come. You're exalted in the heavens, you are high and lifted up. Your glory fills the heavens and the earth. Oh, you're exalted in the heavens, you're high and lifted up. Your glory fills the heavens and the earth. You the Oramashiato, Kevayala Jerase, Tova Dejan Bobo Sera Seveda, Kazambra Zebra de Rodio. Vanjara Zebedi, You are the mighty God, the great I am. Hallelujah, hallelujah.
You are the mighty God, the great I am. Hallelujah, hallelujah.
Let me say this to you with all authority, in all truth, and divine certainty. If you do not let up, but if you will continue to press in for those things that you are already touching, you will find the unlimited dimensions of His divine presence and power and glory being manifested through your lives in such a way that everything that God has said in His Word, you will be able to point to where it happened in your life. Tonight, in the name of Jesus Christ, I want this thing settled and broken, says the Lord, that you do not take anything that is old or anything of the past with you now into the new things and into the future that is set before you at this moment in time. For there is an open door before you. There is an open door set before you. But you cannot bring with you the things of the past. You can't bring with you your failures, your insecurities, your fear, your problems, all the things that you believe about yourself, which, by the way, aren't even true. They're lies. But if you will take a hold of that which is new and say to the old, it's passed away, and lay hold upon that which Father has promised and He cannot lie, who's sworn and has also performed it, then everything about your life will be redefined this very year. Just over the next few months, even. Just over the, not a year. Just over the next few months. Father will not force you and not make you. But if you'll say, yes, oh God, I lay hold on this and I will have it no other way. I will not have the old. I will not have it. I will not have former things in my life. I will only have the God things. The new things. That which He's ordained. It is that easy. It is. Because it's not by might. It's not by power. But it's by the miracle working of the Holy Ghost. It's by my Spirit. I pray that every one of you will recognize that Father has for you the divine power and ability that when you lay hands on people, they encounter the majesty and splendor, and they do not need to be persuaded with words of wisdom or with great speeches or with enticing words. They will have an encounter with the supernatural working of the Spirit of the Lord. Sandy, that's what the Lord will do. That's what the Lord will do. Don't doubt it. That's what the Lord is doing. Don't doubt it. Because you're not willing to be without it. You cannot be. You cannot even see yourself without it. You know that it isn't even right
can be without it. It isn't even right to preach the gospel without the display of such supernatural power. It's not even right. Therefore, you won't be without it. This is not for the fearful, the intimidated, and the unbelieving. They're all without. But for those who will step in to this new thing, God says, all that I have is your inheritance. Revelation chapter 21, verses 1 through 4. Let him that is thirsty come and drink.
Amen.
Hallelujah.
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 Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Lord Jesus. We want you to get your offering ready, get ready to prepare your heart to worship the Lord and your giving. God's going to work a miracle for you through it. I know many of you have financial needs. I know that there you have dreams and you have visions you only God can fulfill through the supply of His riches to you. You go ahead and participate with that which God has called us to do. Give to Him. Honor Him with your tithes and with your offerings. And you watch what God's going to do. He's going to multiply it. Don't hold back from God. He's generous. I promise you, He's not stingy. I promise you, He's not going to run out of finances when it comes to you. Just come worship the Lord. Find a bunch of people around you. Hug them. Bless them. Tell them that you love them. Hallelujah. Just find everybody you can and tell them that you love them. Bless them in Jesus' mighty name. Praise the name of the Lord. If there's anybody who needs prayer for anything, you sick in your body, you got torments in your soul, whatever's going on, Father's here to heal you. He's here to touch you. I can't imagine you aren't already healed and touched, but if you need us to lay hands on you and pray for you, we're here to do that. Just come. Just come. Hallelujah. Yes. Huh? You have one. Where? You do? Something you discovered? Well, I command it to dissolve right now. Dissolve. Dakror masipride. Dakror masipride. Just lay hold on faith. Brosto remendere masaterne. Thank you, Father, for the healing. Don't look in the pot. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Just believe what God said in His Word. Just believe what God said, Father said in His Word. Father, I thank you for the touch of heaven upon your daughter. On your handmaiden. Lord, from the crown of her head to the soles of her feet, everything that belongs to your life and your power and your glory is hers. 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 Belongs to her. Hallelujah. Thank you for our miracle, baby. Hallelujah. Thank you, Lord Jesus. Thank you, mighty God. Father, thank you for your riches and your blessings. I command you in the name of Jesus Christ to prosper.
Yes.
I command you in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ to step in to inheritance. Inheritance. I see an inheritance.
Yes.
I see an inheritance. What do you want? Okay.
Yeah.
Lord Jesus, we thank you for boldness. We thank you for the overwhelming compassion.
Yes, God, yes. Thank you, Father.
That has to precede everything that you ever say.
Yes.
So right now, in the name of Jesus, Elaine, be strengthened by the Spirit in your inner being so that the Holy Ghost moves you beyond fear, moves you beyond self-consciousness, moves you beyond intimidation. There's a realm of heaven. Don't get in a hurry. The Lord speaks to us, implants things into our spirit, to our heart, okay? That then He prepares the seed with the Spirit of the Lord to bring forth the Word, Holy Ghost conviction and power and authority to produce life. So you just lay hold on God. Elaine, just lay hold. Lay hold on the Spirit of the Lord, the Word of the Lord. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you for supernatural power, supernatural ability. Father, you're the one who loves us with an everlasting love. You're the one who commands, and it comes to pass. So, Father, we thank you that in your love and your mercy and your goodness to us, that as we agree with that which you want, because these are the things that he wants, that you work the miracle. We ask you, Lord, work this miracle now. Jesus. Hallelujah. Baby sounds good. What's up? Well, he's healed. He's healed. Now, Lord, we just thank you. Clear out the congestion. Everybody know everything's good. He was burning up with a fever last night. He's fine. Yeah. You're good. You're good, baby. Jesus touches you now. He already touched you. He touches you now. heaven to you. All the way from heaven to you. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Lord Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Lord Jesus. The Ross of the Kaddish. Jesus. Father, we thank you for opening up every spiritual dimension, the realms of heaven, to your daughter, your servant, Zoe. That as she prays for people, your power falls upon them like lightnings from heaven. She ministers. Thank you, Father, for that which you've ordained you and us to bring to pass. Father, we thank you for the great ministries that you're raising up here. The great exploits of God that you would do from the lowly places where men would thought it was impossible that these things could originate. Thank you, Father. Lord, you are God Almighty. You are the one who is in control of all things. You fashioned them and you've ordained them. You set the course and the order of all things. And Lord, we're so blessed tonight to be a part of that course and a part of that order. Oh, living God, accomplish everything that you've willed. Accomplish everything that you yield to us. Thank you, Jesus. Heaven. Huh? Heaven. 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 Thank you, Jesus. Just do what God tells you to do. Just be quick to obey. Don't discuss it. Just do it. Don't sit around and consider it for a while. Just do it. Just do it. Let God have His way. Let Father train you in perfect obedience. Quick to obey. Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you. Father, I thank you for this great anointing and spirit of prayer and divine authority. Oh God, and Holy Ghost gushings from heaven that are coming up out of your servants. And I thank you, Father, for increasing. I thank you, Father, for the great demonstration of your spirit and of your giftings. Of you manifested through your servants' lives. Thank you, Jesus.
Thank you, Jesus. So excited. So blessed. So blessed.
You are the Almighty, the great I am. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. You are the mighty God, the great I am. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. You are the Alpha and Omega, the beginning and the end, who was and is to come. Oh, you are the Alpha and Omega, the beginning and the end, the was and is to come. You are exalted in the heavens. You are high and lifted up. Your glory fills the heavens and the earth. Lord, you are exalted in the heavens. You are high and lifted up. Your glory fills the heavens and the earth. You are the mighty God, the great I am. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. You leave out of here tonight knowing that He's in you, that He's with you, that He accompanies you in more ways than one, that Christ Jesus is in you, the Holy Ghost is in you, He's alongside of you. He's given you power, He's given you authority. Your shadow can cure the sick. Understand that you lay hands on the sick and they'll be cured, that you drive out devils, that you can release people from the power of sin and iniquity over their life. You can see souls saved instantaneously, born again just at the moment of the witness. That every incurable disease is cured in Jesus' name, and everything that Christ Jesus did, He'll do through you and me. Don't doubt it. Don't doubt it. And just be that much more excited about it, that much more certain about it. Declare it, testify of it. Let everybody know this is what's going on. This is what God said. This is what you're doing. Amen.